temple. This that original, the essentials. What you want to do is open up your mental. This is KRS-One. I met you probably outside in the street. Some of y'all hearing this real beat from the elite. I gotta give it up, cause we never done. I like to shout out Pascal, Son One. Shout out Zinaru, G Simone. I'm doing it right now with no microphone. Like I said, I'm opening up the mental. Welcome to the temple. Welcome to the temple of hip hop. What I want you to do now is turn your gospels, if you have one, to the 12th Overstanding. And what we're going to do is we're going to start with an orientation. And this orientation is important. And let me say this, those that have their gospel of hip hop, this is the 12th Overstanding. It's called the Movement. And it's, so I'm on page 494. Page 494, 12th Overstanding, the Movement. Now, like I said, the reason we're starting there or here is because you won't really understand the full teachings and how we're actually coming at the world unless you really understand the history of the movement itself. This is a street ministry. Don't try to compare this to any other ministries. In fact, this is philosophy. This is more of a mystery school kind of setting. We're teaching philosophy because we're in search of the truth and wisdom. This is not religion, and this is not science. This is philosophy, actually the mother of both of them. So sit back and enjoy this orientation. This is the history of our movement and why we are going to teach, or why we teach what we teach. I'm going to turn this over to Minister Son One, someone who you will be hearing more of, along with Minister Zinaru and G. Simone as well, who will be accompanying me in the teachings of this course. Minister Son One is going to walk you through the orientation, and then we'll be right back.
The 12th Overstanding, the Movement. In 1987, Afrika Bambaataa held a cypher discussion at the Latin Quarter nightclub in Manhattan, New York. The topics included the unionizing of rap artists and the further development of hip-hop as its influence began to expand beyond the New York area. At this discussion, with about 50 prominent rap artists, DJs, journalists, b-boys, b-girls, graffiti writers, and other activists present, Afrika Bambaataa argued that without organization and unity, hip-hop would simply become a mass plantation of talented people all working toward the benefit of several corporations. This discussion ended with Daddy-O of Stetsasonic predicting the fall of New York's dominance over the rap music industry and the rise of the West Coast with an MC called Too Short. During this historic meeting, everyone pledged to do their part to protect hip-hop's cultural development. It was around this time, 1987, that we began to think of hip-hop as a culture. But the streets were extremely dangerous during these times. Many hip-hoppers got caught up in the emerging crack cocaine drug scene. Automatic weapons found their way onto the streets of New York and into the hands of hip-hoppers. When armed, most hip-hoppers used their weapons to protect themselves against the lawlessness of the streets, while others used their weapons for robberies, kidnappings, murders, and intimidation. But when DJ Scott LaRock was killed in the Bronx trying to break up a street dispute, all hip-hoppers were saddened. The drug wars of the 1980s broke all of the original street codes that protected and empowered hip-hop's community leaders. It became every man, woman, for themselves. Many were killed. The murder of Scott LaRock in August of 1987 was the first of its kind for the hip-hop community. However, Scott LaRock would not be the last prominent hip-hop artist that would be killed by the escalation of street violence caused by the introduction of crack cocaine and guns into predominantly black and brown neighborhoods. But as bad as things were then, we were still not powerless. the conscious hip-hop community inspired by Afrika Bambaataa began to mobilize and organize against such violence. The police and other law enforcement agencies were not only powerless against the crack cocaine drug movement of the 1980s, but because of such powerlessness, many of them joined in on the sale of illegal drugs and guns within black and brown communities. Black and brown leaders were also powerless, and many of them, fearing for their own lives, turned their heads when crack cocaine was being sold to young black and brown teenagers. From the east to the west coast of the United States, gangs of black and brown youths were enlisted and protected by American law enforcement agencies to terrorize black and brown neighborhoods as the drugs and guns flowed in. Finally, in 1989, the violence and lawlessness of the 1980s reached its peak when a young man was fatally stabbed at a rap concert in New York City for his jewelry. The then head of A&R for Jive Records, Ann Carley, Tokyo Rose, was so moved by the event that she approached author activist Nelson George and I, KRS-One, to form the Stop the Violence movement based on a song that I had written 1 year earlier entitled Stop the Violence. Between the three of us, we organized the production of a song entitled Self-Destruction, a chorus chant written by Dougie Fresh with music produced by D. Nice. Other artists such as Heavy D and the Boys, MC Light, Just Ice, MC Delight, Wise, Daddy-O, Fruquan, Kool Moe Dee, Miss Melody, and Public Enemy also donated their lyrical performance to this cause.
These people are the Self-Destruction Stop the Violence movement, and you're about to watch the Self-Destruction video.
Peace.
Hey. Hollywood, look out.
Tonight, all of the speakers have agreed that America has a very serious problem.
Not only does
America have a very serious problem, our people have a very serious problem. America's problem is
what?
Violence was a freestyle because every time we went to do a show, somebody would start acting stupid. So we'd have something to say even as that was going on because the music never stopped. So I wrote it as a freestyle, but then we never really did it because, you know, it just never came around. We never had the opportunity to set it up right and do it. So I met these kids that made this beat. The beat goes bo 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 bo. Well, the original musicians, I met them, they had a crew called Jam Rock Massive. Jam Rock Massive put out Stop the Violence, the first record, as a bootleg because we did it together. And I said, if in fact I sell the record somewhere, I'll give you some credit on it and some points. We'll work out a deal. They did the music. I wrote the song and then mixed it. By that time, I had signed the Jive, and I said, well, yo, that's still my record. Yo, what's up? They said, well, we want X amount of dollars and so on for the record. So I said, of course, we had nothing signed. I just said, all right, I'll just drop it and leave it there. You do what you want with that, and I'm going to do what I want with this. So I went and started my Stop the Violence beat, which is do 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 do. I went and put that out on the By All Means Necessary LP. What happened is that that record became, of course, larger than the bootleg. And it became like a little anthem within hip-hop music. Stop the Violence in hip-hop, YL, okay. What happened is, jumped on the Dope Jam Tour, rocking the Dope Jam Tour. The last show of the Dope Jam Tour was at Nassau Coliseum. Nassau Coliseum was like the most packed show out ever. It was like, you know, the show of shows for that session of time. But what happened was that the security, due to some other stuff, the security had quit on the tour. And when they quit, we had no security at Nassau Coliseum. You have Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan, Bronx, Staten Island, Long Island, Jersey in the house. They started bugging. What happened was this kid got killed over a gold chain there. Out of all the many things that went on that night, that seemed to be the zenith of the ignorance. He died because of his gold chain, stabbed in the heart, I think it was.
We were watching the concert, looking at how production was performing, and the next thing I know, it just a whole bunch of people just crowded into the corridor, but nothing had happened yet. So, you know, they had, one guy had saw me with my gold on, so he reached for my bracelet, one of my bracelets, because my hand was on the railing, and he grabbed one of my bracelets. So when I turned, I grabbed him. And once I grabbed him, a whole crowd rushed behind me. When I turned around to see the crowd, there were just bodies flying at me. So I just ducked down. When I ducked down, they just piled on top of me. And I didn't realize I was stabbed until everything had, you know, it was all over. But by this time, my bracelet was gone, three chains were gone, my gold watch was gone, and a friend of mine had got hit, and because he was trying to help me out. Next thing I know, a friend of mine tells me all of this blood is on my pants, and I turn around and lift my shirt up, and blood just starts gushing out. So I go to the first aid office. When I go into the first aid office, it's crowded, you know, full of people that have been stabbed and cut, and, you know, it's like, so. It had to be like a little SWAT team going around, you know, cutting people up, stabbing them up. You know, that's crazy.
When I heard about the murder at the Nassau Coliseum, I was really shocked, and I knew what had happened because I had been at a previous show there about a couple of weeks before, which had been a PE show, and Run DMC had been on that show, which had been, I think it had been about a month before, the Dope Jam show. I saw the security guards watching violence and not doing anything. I saw the fact that the security guards disappeared at certain times in the show. So I saw the fact, basically, it was a very, inside the arena, the criminal element had control. Once you got outside, you saw mounted police on horses, etc., who were basically swinging at anything that was in the crowd, not at the criminal element, but at just kids in general. So I saw the fact that basically, the manpower at the arena, in my opinion, had either been unwilling or afraid, for some reason, to really provide real security for the paying patrons, the people who come to see the show. So when I heard about the murder, which occurred about a month or so later at the Dope Jam show, I knew what had happened. I mean, there was no question in my mind what it went down. And I knew also how it would be played. It was not going to be played as an incident of inadequate security, which is what it was, and it was at many of these rap shows. It's an incident of they're going to say it was an incident of black-on-black violence, of rap violence, and that's the phrase that was utilized.
You go to Bruce Springsteen concert, and you don't see any white boys killing each other, but, you know, in a rap concert where the audience is predominantly black, it's all of this black-on-black crime, and it's like, you know, it's like a sickness that I think nobody's really paying attention to how deep, you know, the ramifications of that is, so... It was really, really frustrating, you know. As a matter of fact, while I was on stage, I think that was the worst performance I had on the whole tour because I was, like, tense, I wasn't loose, and it was almost to the point, like, I wanted to get on stage and preach.
That they would kill somebody else's black over something like gold, you know, that they gonna sell probably to get some drugs or to get some money that they gonna use up in the next week, and then they gonna go out and do it again. You know, it's just like a cycle, you know. It makes no sense, not to me.
It's time for people in the rap music industry to begin to say, address not only their image problem, but the real issues that are causing the problem. And so we decided to start to Stop the Violence movement.
We as adult black Americans have a large problem because we are not role models in our homes. We are not heroes, and we need to become heroes.
The artist's response was incredible. I was not at all, I didn't want to approach any mainstream R&B people because I knew what it would be. It would be, I got to talk to my manager, my booking agent, my record company's right from the image. The people in rap knew what it was about immediately. And the response was incredible. We had to keep people off the record in order to try and get it done. That was that kind of response. And that's why we're able to do a video like we're able to do this music video, because they got up early in the morning, which rappers are not known for.
Blood.
Was there to do the job and to make the statement they wanted to make.
I know we're in Harlem. Where?
Harlem.
This is Harlem? Yeah, this is Harlem. What do you think this is?
I figured that it's time that we spoke up about this, you know, from the artist's point of view.
And we just feel that one of the primary duties of a rapper in this day and age is to become a positive role model in the minds and in the hearts of the children, because a lot of these kids don't have positive role models to look up to. In most neighborhoods, drug dealer is the role model. So, you know, if we could continue to do projects like this, then we show them something to look forward to.
We're totally against black-on-black crime, you know? I mean, it's so ridiculous in this day and time that our own brothers and sisters has got to pick up arms against one another. You know, we're killing ourselves off, man. And this is a definite message to all the young people.
We strongly believe that, you know, violence is nonsense. We've got to get together as one. And if you look around, you see a whole lot of different type of rappers here getting together to prove that everybody can get together.
That's the first time this has really happened. Because, you know, a lot of these brothers won't even speak to each other. Mm-hmm. You understand? So the beauty of this is that regardless if we disagree on 99 things, we agree on one, that we need to come together.
We want to let the youth know that there are alternatives to crime in your community. There are alternatives to having disrespect for your brother and your sister. African Americans must come to the realization that if we do not help ourselves in this regard, we will be the greatest. We will bear the brunt of crime as it affects us.
I would have to say that there were several times during the recording of the record and the shooting of the video that I just didn't think it was gonna happen.
The camera's gonna be on the crane coming along this way, catching you all as each of you do the lyrics. So you gotta sit in the order that you kick the lyrics on the song, right? And then when it goes all the way to the end, to the last person, it's gonna come up to show the crowd in the background. Okay, so it's important that you guys are sitting down in the right order. That's what we're trying to get right now.
Sitting?
Yeah, sitting here. That's how it's gonna start. That's one of the master shots.
We're setting up for the shot. We need you now.
Melvin is right over here.
We need you over here. And Doug, sure.
Yeah, I will.
Yeah.
Blaine, we need you.
Melody.
What's up?
This is going out to all the youth. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Which is, you know, a lot of people that look up to us. We are role models, you know what I'm saying? So we got to do the right thing in front of them at all times. We got to say the right things in front of them at all times. And we got to try to teach them to strive for perfection, because that is the right direction. And if anything is wrong, then we will make a correction. And how we do that? Because we have the detection.
Ho.
You know what I'm saying? And that's what time it is, so we'll add it to the collection.
Slide down, guys.
To where?
Slide down, we gotta separate.
Everybody, right. Slide down.
Flay, you over here. You over here, Flay.
The idea of the video shoot itself just seemed to be so massive, because we were going from place to place and we had so many artists, and all the artists had their entourages with them, and I just don't know how they kept it together. I don't know how the people at Classic Concepts kept us all together, because between Nelson and I, we were like, you know, nervous wrecks.
We need a lane free. We're in a nice space
there. It really ain't the rap audience that's bugging. It's one or two suckers, ignorant brothers, trying to rob and steal from one another. You get caught in the mid. So to crush that stereotype, here's what we did. We got ourselves together so that you could unite and fight for what's right. Not negative cause. The way we live is positive. We don't kill our relatives.
Pop, 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 when it's shot, who's to blame? Headline, front page, and rap's the name. MC Delight here to state the bottom line. The black on black crime was way before our time.
Took a brother's life with a knife as his wife cried, cause he died a trifling death when he left his very last breath. Was I slept, so watch your step. Back in the 60s, our brothers and sisters were hanged. How could you gang bang? I never ever ran from the Ku Klux Klan, and I shouldn't have to run from a black man, cause that's
self-destruction.
I would say Miss Melody, D-Nice, and probably some of the Stetsasonic brothers were the ones, Wise and Fuquan were the ones who the most debate was about. Because certain elements of people who wanted to be involved in the record felt that they weren't large enough. Miss Melody's record hadn't come out yet. And Dee Nice had been working with Chris, but it wasn't acknowledged on his own yet. And I remember Miss Melody just being very pleasant and dealing with it very well. Dee Nice had a lot more problems because he had a lot more conflicts. There was actually some conflicts that went on in the making of the record. And Dee Nice was at the center of one of the conflicts. In fact, to this day, he has a rivalry of some kind with one of the other rappers involved in the project, which is interesting.
What's up? My name is Derek, but they call me Dee Nice, and I am the producer of Self-Destruction. That came about because Chris, which y'all know as KRS-One, he really didn't have time to do the music, so he basically asked me to come up with a beat for it. And I came up with the beat that y'all hear. We submitted tapes to everyone to see how they liked it. A lot of people said it was okay, and they thought it can be better. And they really criticized me a lot for it, but I really thank them because without their criticism, I really wouldn't have went back in the studio and did the best job that I thought I can do. You know, it would have been just that.
Dougie, again, someone everyone wanted to have on there, but it was hard getting a hold of him all the time. And when he came in, I never forget, he came in tonight, he listened to the track after some other people had laid down their raps, and he wasn't totally with it. And Hank Shockley, who was associate producer, was there that night. And Hank actually, and he sat in the studio and did some things. They really did some things with the track, because they had been working on Dougie's album. And Dougie, his section, the whole, he actually gave us a bridge. I mean, the record needed a bridge, and his section is actually the bridge to the record because it has a kind of a change of pace and his own instrumental stuff. Quite brilliant. I mean, Doug really came in. He had a feeling it needed to be more danceable, and he made sure that it worked. I mean, I think that his section, again, is one of the highlights. And that whole idea of using his voice and all that stuff in a moment of silence, that's all his, and it's all Dougie, and it's again, I think, again, some of his best work, actually.
It doesn't make you a big man, and to one and go and dish your brother, man, and you don't know that's part of the plan.
Why was that music as a full demand?
I mixed the record. It took me 2 days to mix it. I stayed in the studio for like about 36 hours, you know, straight, just to make sure that everybody on the record could have their own spotlight, even though they were already established artists. But I wanted to make it seem more than just everyone's rapping on this one record. So I'd switch the beat under, like if Public Enemy was rapping, I'd put Funky Drummer, you know, since they're known for using Funky Drummer and rocking it in various ways, I put Funky Drummer under it. And when Step was rhyming, I put Talking All That Jazz under while Step was rhyming. And you know, same thing goes with Light and Heavy D.
Here's the situation. Idiocy, nonsense, violence. Not a good policy, therefore we must ignore fighting, fussing. Heaven's at the door, so there'll be no bum rushing. Let's get together because we're falling apart. I heard a brother shot another, it broke my heart. I don't understand the difficulty, people. Love your brother, treat him as an equal. They call us animals, I don't agree with them. I'll prove them wrong, but right is what you're proving them. Take heed before I leave to what I'm saying, or we'll all be on our knees, pray.
I remember being at a concert in Madison Square Garden. Heavy, how do I get on this record? Who do I have to talk to get this record? I want to be in the record. He was like that about it. And when he came into the studio, his rap was already written. He and Kumo D were probably the two most professional and on point. And when I say, they came in, they had their stuff ready, they did it, boom, they were in and out, just real sharp. The Stop the Violence record is really, I think we'll go down in history if you look at the, is a record which represents the New York mentality of rap and also the New York mentality of street life culture. I mean, the record really reflects the fact that people in New York went through their gangster stage. I mean, we don't have the gangs in New York in the late 80s, early 90s that they have in other parts of the country. For some reason, the chemistry here has not brought that about. And so we have a lot more consciousness. The whole Malcolm X movement, Afrocentricity, all of these positive things, understanding or appreciation of Islam as part of the continuity of religion, and that Christianity is not the only religion. All these different things that are going through black culture, you can see that are reflected in self-destruction. And I think that's one of the things that's going to be good about in the long run, that it's a document of a certain mentality that was going on.
Scott LaRock was like the original founder of Boogie Down Productions, him along with Chris. And you know, it was a real sad thing. It was a big loss. And it was kinda, you know, coming there for me. You know, that's one of the reasons why it happened. And I would never forget him. And I hope nobody out there ever forget him. You know, as long as I make records, people will know who Scott, you know, who he was.
Scott was down for that message also, you know. It's just a shame he died under the same circumstances as self-destruction is trying to prevent.
After he passed, you know, Chris didn't really want to get anyone else to DJ, so he basically put me in to do that job. So it was kind of bug how it happened.
You know, I came down to do this for the best. This is my man KRS-One. Why he's KRS-One? Because there's only one KRS, boy.
But there is a couple of delights, and here's one of them. MC Delight.
That's right. And then they got Chicken Delight.
He's going to just do a few. You heard somebody else, and as soon as he comes in,
I'm going to start raising the camera. After I do, on the part where I say, come on, and start coming down this way.
You said the joint is like this.
Okay.
The camera's starting to go up, right?
All right, so then.
But you still do the same move. You still go here.
Yeah, so I just end up right here. Right. So we got to keep ourselves and shit, or else just bang.
Right.
Really, you really got an insight into how PE works. Because Chuck had written out both their parts. Flavors as well as his. And even the way it would be phrased, it was amazing. And he cut his vocal without, and he even did like Flavor's part, and then Flavor came in and overdubbed his part, more or less. And, you know, is the Classic Concepts crew can attest. We had to go out, because we never did get Chuck to the master shot. So we ended up getting Chuck, taping him out at the old recording radio station where they started in college, out at Adelphi, along with him in Terminator X. And actually, it worked out very well visually. It gave us another element for the piece, though. At the time, we thought it was going to be a disaster, and it worked out very well.
Spread out! Spread out! Everybody spread out! Spread out! Spread out! Spread out! Spread out! Where's the peace sign?
Job to build and collect ourselves with intellect.
Come on.
To revolve, to evolve the self-respect.
Cause we got to keep ourselves in check, or else it's
say your parent comes home and wants to play as Anita Baker, or she wants to play as Anita Baker, and the child comes home and want to play his or her Kool Moe Dee, and the parent will say, you know, like, why don't you cut that down? But the parent is going to his or her room, if the parent is around, and be what he or she is into. Therefore, because of the parent neglecting to communicate with his or her child, Kool Moe Dee takes the place of the parent, because the communication process is taking place. Kool Moe Dee is communicating something across to that child that the child can relate to.
I ain't looking at you. I'm about to fuck.
tag in front of the building like you was told.
In the blue, you need 2 sheets. It's half blue. So 2 sheets makes a full blue.
First, Ann didn't want me to get down with this because she said my image was like a gangster. And she said she didn't want nobody ever has had an image like that to get down with this. And we, you know, we convinced her that I was right for it. I felt like if younger people and kids could see me in a Stop the Violence video, maybe they know it's for real.
Start tight on him, but as he comes up, start to hold him in the heel.
Like this. Put your head on the dollar so we can walk this move out. Yeah. Starts the lyrics like this. All right. And he just gets up, comes to me. Keep on walking to me. Walk. Slowly. You're in the goal by the time he gets out of that gate.
This is a tool that is underutilized. Rappers are talking to the kids, and the kids are listening.
Straight from the mouth of Wild and Daddy, yo. Do a crime, end up in jail, it gotta go.
Cause you could do crime and get paid today, and tomorrow you're behind bars in the worst way.
Far from your family, cause you're locked away. Now tell me, do you really think crime pays?
Even on taking what your brother had, you little sucker.
You talking all that jazz.
Yeah, that's right. Get
program when Chris had originally done Stop the Violence, and Ann Carling, Nelson George thought that it would be a good idea if they incorporated various artists to kind of like spread the message a little further.
No problem.
My part in the song is almost self-explanatory. I say that the violence in rap, I'm speaking of rap because that's where my career is, my life is in rap. And I want to let the rap audience know that, well, the violence incorporated in our little clique, we have to stop it. And it has to start with the artists. And, you know, even if you don't stop it at once, they hear the message.
Self-destruction, you had for self-destruction. Self-destruction, you had for self-destruction. I'm Miss Melody and I'm a boy again. The bombs in the back will cease to set. If we want to grow to another level, we can't be getting things from the depth. But enemy knows, they're no fools, because everyone knows the hip-hop rules. So we got to get and grab what's wrong. The opposition is weak.
Hi again.
Hi, how are you?
All right.
You know something? Every time I turn around, you're always in my face.
Cut.
Today's topic, self-destruction. You really ain't the rap audience is bugging. It's one of two suckers, ignorant brothers, trying to rob and steal from one another. You get caught in the mid, so to crush that stereotype is what we did. We got ourselves together. Black, white, and white, cry.
Delight was really, again, who came to a lot of meetings, was very involved. His speech at the press conference was one of the best. Just quite good and quite dedicated to the idea. I was impressed with that a lot. Daddy-O as well.
This particular project here, Self-Destruction, is dealing with specifically black-on-black violence.
Black-on-black crime, man, we only hurt ourselves. We make ourselves look like fools.
And you got to stop the killing of each other, putting our bloods in the street, black-on-black crime, stealing from each other. Like the Kumo D said, you know, it's a shame that we got to run from another black man.
Like the guys that are stealing and robbing are not even looking at it as a black on black thing. They're just, you know, going for theirs and like, I'm gonna get as much jewelry or as much money as I can. And they're not looking at what they're doing to the race as a whole.
Basically what this is simply saying is that, of course, we're not trying to front. We're not telling the kids we made a record about still self-destruction, so you should stop the violence. Nonsense. We're telling more the police officers and the industry that there's a more serious side to rap music than, yo, man, blah, 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 talking about nothing. As you can see, everybody here is down for the cause. Everybody here is rocking sincerely. Is that right? Okay. Ta-da.
I think Chris has been the most consistent person in hip hop and articulating a non-violent but realistic approach to dealing with these issues. I mean, Chris uses violent imagery, but it's very clear from his music, unlike a lot of other people who use violent imagery, this is a message, and the point he uses violence to illustrate a point of information. He's very, very good at doing that. And, I don't think there would have been a record to stop the violence movement or self-destruction without Chris's participation.
It's one of two suckers, ignorant brothers, trying to rob and steal from one another. You get caught in the mix. That stereotype, here's what we did. We got ourselves together so that you can unite and fight for what's right. Not negative cause. The way we live is positive. We don't tell our relatives. Pop, 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 what a shot, who's to blame? Headlines, front page, rap, the main. MC's the right here to take the bottom line. The black on black crime is way before time.
We have. Sure? She's the opening. He's the opening. I'm not gonna come out of the album.
Everyone, thank you very much. You all did fine. We just need to get some close-ups of D-Nice and Just Dice. Everyone else.
See, she even rhymes when she talks, and she knows what she's doing.
So we're done. Thank you very much.
Live from New York, I don't care you in LA, I don't care you in Miami, I don't care you in Houston, I don't care you in Chicago, I don't care you in Detroit, I don't care you in Bangladesh, wherever we go, stop the violence. This is all I got to say.
It was like self-destruction in addition to the Jack of Spades movie, I'm Gonna Get You Sucker movie, gold chains went out of season. Big thick chains was gone now. A more intelligent look came about the rap industry. And personally, I believe that it's because of movements like Boogie Down Production, Stop the Violence Movement, Public Enemy, that has saved rap music, literally. If rap had gone on with its egotistical, sexist attitude, it would be dead right now. You'd be talking to Anthrax instead of Boogie Down Productions. But what happened was the consciousness of rap has been changed due to these movements. And people are really, whether it's a fad or true, people are looking to find themselves. And I think that's one of the biggest changes that jumped off, specifically coming out of the hand of the Stop the Violence movement, specifically. It was a movement, it was a fad that was it was intelligence as a fad. And fads are laws, period.
A bad parent, a father alcoholic, a mother crack, hid. That should be an example for us all, for all the young people in here. It should serve as an example for what we should not be, because we can use the bad example, right, as a strong leg to push on to something different, something positive. You see, because y'all the bridge to the next generation. So you got to be the best type of parent that y'all can be. You got to go back on that corner like my man Daddy-O said and pick up that black book and get an identity for yourself. Because once you have an identity for yourself, then you can establish a direction.
I guess I got involved through Nelson George because of I Cramble Understand You, which was like a pitch for no drugs because of Hamhead Sam.
Light was a first choice of everybody. Everyone, the minute we came with the idea, we wanted Light. Because she done Crammed Under Sam You Sam, which was a great anti-crack record. And she had a certain kind of homegirl vulnerability and just credibility that we thought was essential for the record to work.
It's nice. Yeah, this area pretty nice. Yeah, it kind of works down a little bit.
Put one in the middle of the
sun. Please get out of the street, thank you.
I gave all the statistics, a lot of stuff that actually appears in the video, I gave out to the artist when they were making up their raps. And she had come back with a rap which was very fact-based. And then she heard Kumo D's rap and a couple of others, she said, no, mine is too fact, I need to have more flavor to it. And so she was in the studio one night just trying to come up with her rap. And the same night, this was Chung King. So LL Cool J was doing his Panther album downstairs in one of the other rooms. So he came in, and they had this like playful banter going on. He'd come in and flirt with her, and then he would give her a couple of lines, and he'd walk out. Then he'd come back 15 minutes later and flirt with her some more and give her another line. And she was like, just stay here and say, what did you say? It was really funny. She was writing down what he said. So it was really, really a funny scene. Because he wouldn't be on the record, but he wanted to be on the record. So finally, he ended up giving her some of the best lines. And she took what she already had and mixed in his lines. And her rap is really a combination of her and LL, the only known collaboration.
Before I started rapping, I used to party a lot. And I know that's a scared feeling to be inside a club. You know, you're coming to see somebody that you like to perform or whatever, like to see perform, and then you have to start running from something. You don't know what it is because the crowd is like going crazy or whatever. So it's kind of hectic. It's wild.
And what about when you're on stage? How do you feel when you're on stage? Like last night, did a fight break out when you were there and you were on stage?
Yeah, in North Carolina. And they had to push me off of the stage. So I didn't feel anything but hands pushing me.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's like depressing sort of to see these things happen.
It's like you pay your money to go see a show, but you end up seeing a boxing match. You know, you want to see a rap show. It's like frustrating, man. You know, people get scared to go places now. You can't sit around, do nothing without somebody trying to threaten your life or something.
You know, people don't even think when they start fighting. They just fight.
Everyone come back.
You're gonna start over here. You're gonna start right over here like this. Now hold it. This is why this split is important to get. You gotta get like, all right. No, you're fine. You're right over here. You're gonna start like right over here and come in like this to the camera. That's how you start your line. All right? So you're blocked here. You come in, and then I want to see how you play. Well, all these people are turned. They only their backs are to you. You had the show canceled. Latin quarter closed due to violence. You gotta kind of relate the lyrics to where you are. But your movement can only be like right here. You come back this far. You come in. You know, but I don't want you to go all the way back here. All right? You ever like, you know, want to like make a point to Kane, turn you back. Like that. Yeah, if you want to make a point to Kane, you just go like that, and he's gonna turn around. You know. But as soon as the music starts, I want everybody's back to be turned this way. Only when light starts to
light. Self-destruction.
Funky Grace dressed to impress, ready to party. Money in your pocket, dying to move your body. To get inside, you pay the whole $10. Got tape with a razor blade, tape to your collar. Leave the guns in the crack and the knobs alone. MC lights on the microphone, bum rushing and pushing, snatching and taxing. I can't understand why brothers don't be maxing. There's only one disco, they'll close one more. You ain't guarding the door, so what you got a gun for? Do you rob the rich and give to the poor? Yo, daddy, you shoot some more.
This way from the mouth, and daddy.
Yo,
Believe in people, basically, and a lot of people think that's a really stupid, corny thing to do and you're just going to get slapped down for doing it. This project, this record, the whole Stop the Violence movement has proved my point that people are the very, very thing that you should believe in, because that's what made this whole project happen. Everybody donating their time, arguing back and forth about how to do it, giving of, you know, of themselves creatively, that's how this record happened. That's, and you know, I think that's the best thing that came out of it.
I'd like to take this opportunity to give you a few of the details of the actual record. It was released on Martin Luther King's birthday this year, and on that day it played on about 50 radio stations across the country at 12 noon as a tribute to Dr. King. Since its release, we've had gross orders of about 100,000 units. That's combined 12-inch singles and cassette singles. And this week I'm happy to say that we were the Hot Shot debut entry in the Billboard Black Singles Chart. The record has also been released in the UK, where it's entered the pop charts at 75 this week, and it's scheduled for release in countries across Europe as well as Japan. All proceeds from this record, both domestic and worldwide, will be donated to the National Urban League's programs involved in black and black crime and youth education.
These young people are united, bonded by a common cause to communicate the idea that crime is no longer acceptable in the African American community. We are all known to statistics. We have been victimized either directly or indirectly by crime. When compared to white Americans, it is a fact that African Americans are twice as likely to be victims of violent crimes and twice as likely to be robbed. 90% of robberies against blacks are committed by other blacks. 85% of the assaults in the black community are blacks assaulting blacks. 95% of all homicides are committed by blacks and are against other blacks. In fact, for African Americans, males ages 16 to 34, the leading cause of death is murder or homicide. Quite simply, if you think black on black crime isn't your problem, we say you should think again.
We're flavor.
Hey, Ricky.
I don't know, you should have been.
Damn, we're flavor. You gonna walk in crazy or what?
You doing something on the Stop the Violence campaign and rap, stopping black on black crime, stopping gang violence, drug related violence, all unnecessary violence. Stop it right now.
Back up, please.
Self-destructive proceeds is not just good public relations. It is a black collection of black artists working with a black institution to deal with a black problem. It's a sort of social self-help that is essential in this era of social irresponsibility by the government. That's why we have the Stop the Violence movement.
We've made a lot of kids aware in a way that reached them about the problems of violence among people, about the problems of what happens if you don't take responsibility for yourself.
I think the most tangible thing is obviously the book, which is basically a collection of, I did a couple of essays. One is a history of how we made the record. Another is You Must Learn, which deals with the idea of education, self-awareness, and education as a tool against ignorance and a tool against violence. Which, and as part of that, we have the a reading list supplied by Chuck D, KRS-One, and myself, of books we recommend for young people to read. And there's another section, and it's inspired by Kumo D's rap, which deals with the whole question of black-on-black crime and uses the whole analogy of the Ku Klux Klan that he started in his rap. And then also, I think most powerfully, are the letters from young people around the country, which were received as a result of a contest we had with Word Up magazine. Some of the letters, amazing stuff in terms of just dealing with the experiences of kids. And 13, 14-year-old kids who've seen relatives murdered, have seen people, bullets flying through their house. I mean, reading the letters the first time around, it really, when you hear a letter from a 13-year-old kid who's seen his cousin shot in front of his eyes, it really touches you. And I think that these letters in there that we use excerpts of were, some were quite amazing.
For the first time in probably nonprofit history, something directly towards the African, for the African, has been done specifically. In the future, we'll broaden it towards humanity, but this particular record and movement went specifically towards the African, I think.
But again, I think what really, for me, the idea, stop the violence, self-destruction, putting those ideas out in a world where kids are confronted with Rambo and images of violence, and violence is celebrated, not by black media, but by the mainstream of Hollywood, and try and give them something else to deal with. I mean, if you talk about violence, when you see a rapper in a video with a gun, he doesn't have the gun necessarily because the dope man has a gun. He has a gun because everything in American culture tells him that to be a man is to have a gun. That to be Sly, to be Arnold, to be even Eddie Murphy, you know, to be any of these icons of the culture, to be John Wayne, to be Don Johnson, is to have a gun and to be able to enforce your will through violence. That's the kind of mentality we're fighting. We're not just fighting a ghetto mentality at all. We're fighting a cultural mentality that's celebrated every Saturday night in this country. So a record like Self-Destruction is an attempt to try and deal not just with a black-on-black thing, though that's the nutshell, is trying to deal with, we have a culture which celebrates violence as a way to manhood. So, I mean, it's not a black thing. This is one thing, it's not a black thing. It's an American thing. Bottom line, as long as there's poverty, as long as there's poor education, as long as there's no opportunities, there'll be violence. Poverty creates violence. Whether you're in Ireland, Beirut, Johannesburg, or Cleveland, poverty creates violence. That's just the way it's always been in the world. What you have to try and do, and what things I just try and do, is say, look, you know, the social conditions lead you to steal, lead you to do other things, but you have to try and fight that. Because the bottom line, for me, is that it's a moral decision. There's always these moments of decision in your life where you decide what you're going to do. And if we can do anything to put an idea out there that's going to make you make a decision other than to do violence, then we've done something good.
So listen, for the children and for all the kids, you know, y'all striving the way of progress. We'll show you as much as we can along the way. You know, you got 125th Street, you got Harlem, you got a lot. Just a man out on the corner selling black books right now. You have to do what you have to do in order to learn about yourself and your culture. So y'all keep on striving. To the parents, in the words of Pee Wee Herman, I know who I am. Who are you? Peace.
We all agree tonight, all of the speakers have agreed, that America has a very serious problem. Not only does America have a very serious problem, but our people have a very serious problem. America's problem is
self-destruction. Get it for self-destruction. Self-destruction. Get it for self-destruction. Self-destruction. Get it for self-destruction. Self-destruction. Get it for self-destruction.
Well, today's topic, self-destruction, it really ain't the rap audience is bugging. It's one or two suckers, ignorant brothers, trying to rob and steal from one another. You get caught in the mid. So to crush that stereotype, here's what we did. We got ourselves together so that you could unite and fight for what's right. Not negative cause. The way we live is positive. We don't kill our relatives.
Pop, 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 when it shot, who's to blame? Headline, front page, and rap's the name. MC Delight here to state the bottom line. The black on black crime was way before our time.
Took a brother's life with a knife as his wife cried, cause he died a trifling death when he left his very last breath. Was I slept, so watch your step. Back in the 60s, our brothers and sisters were hanged. How could you gangbang? I never ever ran from the Ku Klux Klan, and I shouldn't have to run from a black man, cause that
self-destruction, yeah, it was self-destruction. Self-destruction, yeah, it was self-destruction. Self-destruction.
Funky fresh, dressed to impress, ready to party. Money in your pocket, dying to move your body. To get inside, you pay the whole $10. Scotch tape with a razor blade, tape to your collar. Leave the guns in the crack and the knobs alone. MC Lights on the microphone. Bum rushing and pushing, snatching and taxing. I crammed understand why brothers don't be maxing. There's only one disco, they'll close one more. You ain't guarding the door, so what you got a gun for? Do you rob the rich and give to the poor? Yo, daddy, yo.
Straight from the mouth
of why
and daddy yo
do a crime,
end up in jail,
it gotta go. Cause you could do crime and get paid today,
and tomorrow you're behind bars in the worst way.
Far from your family,
cause you're locked away.
Now tell me,
do you really think crime pays?
Scheming on taking what your brother has?
You little sucker, you talking all that jazz.
It's time to stand together in a unity. Cause if not, then yo, we're soon to be self-destroyed. Unemployed, the rap race will be lost without a trace. Or a clue, but what to do is stop the violence and kick the science down the road that we call eternity, where knowledge is formed and you learn to be self-sufficient, independent. To teach to each is what rap intended, but society wants to invade. So do not walk this path that they laid. It's
self-destruction. Get ready for self-destruction. Self-destruction.
D-Nice, break it down like this.
Children growing, women producing, men go working, some go stealing.
Self-destruction, get ready for self-destruction. Self-destruction.
I miss melody and I'm a born again rebel. The violence in rap must cease and settle. If we want to develop and grow to another level, we can't be guinea pigs for the devil. Knows the hip-hop rules, so we gotta get a grip and grab what's wrong. The opposition is weak and rap is strong.
This is all about, no doubt, to stop violence. But first, let's have a moment of silence. Swing. Things been stated, re-educated, evaluated. Thoughts of the past have faded. The only thing left is the memories of our belated. And I hate it when someone dies to get all hurt up for a silly gold chain by a chump.
Word up.
It doesn't make you a big man. And to one and go and dish your brother, man. And you don't know that's part of the plan. Why? Cause rap music is in full demand. Understand?
Self-destruction.
My name is Just Ice, a man, not a prankster. I was known as the gangster. But believe me, that is no fun. The time is now to unite everyone. You don't have to be soft to be for peace. Robbing and killing and murdering is the least. You don't have to be chained by the beast. But party people is tired. crime I release.
Hey yo, here's the situation. Any odyssey, nonsense, violence, not a good policy. Therefore, we must ignore, fight and fuss it. Heaven's at the door, so there'll be no bum rushing. Let's get together because we're falling apart. I heard a brother shot another, it broke my heart. I don't understand the difficulty, people. Love your brother, treat him as an equal. They call us animals, I don't agree with them. I'll prove them wrong, but right is what you're proving them. Take heed before I leave to what I'm saying, or we'll all be on our knees praying.
Heavy deep, deep in the heart of the matter. The self-destruction is served on a platter. Making a day, not failing to anticipate. They got greedy, so they fell for the bait. That makes them a victim, picked and plucked. New jack in jail, but to the vets, they're a duck. There's no one around, cause in jail, you're a number. They never took the time to wonder about
self-destruction. Game for self-destruction.
To merge, we live for the love of our people, the hope to get along.
Yeah, so we did a song.
Getting a point to our brothers and sisters who don't know the time.
Boy, so we wrote a rhyme.
Instead in your head, you know our job to build and collect ourselves with intellect.
Come on.
To revolve, to evolve the self-respect.
Cause we got to keep ourselves in check, or else it's
self-destruction.
After raising $600,000 for the National Urban League with the proceeds from our self-destruction song, we began to investigate the root causes of violence for ourselves. We found that illiteracy, poverty, lack of purpose, poor law enforcement practices, and media hype all contribute to heightening the levels of aggression in society and can cause violence to occur. We found that it is not the youth of the United States that are the cause of violence. It is primarily the adults, especially those in civil service positions. We found that American society has laws and other mechanisms to keep the peace, but that those in charge of keeping the peace have simply dropped the ball. For whatever reason, the mechanisms put in place to curb violence and overly aggressive behavior in society have been undermined and in some cases attacked by those who benefit from an aggressive populace. The hip-hop community responded. With this revelation, we fought back. On the West Coast in California in 1990, rival Crip and Blood gang members called for a truce and an end to street violence. Stan Tookie Williams, founder of the Crips, declared gangbanging to be dead and even went as far as to denounce the Crips and all gang activity. In commemoration of such a monumental shift in consciousness, activists Mike Conception, Yvonne Kelly, and Leonard Richardson organized the West Coast version of the song Self-Destruction, entitled We Are All in the Same Gang, produced by Dr. Dre. King T, Body and Soul, Def Jeff, Michelle, Tone Loc, Above the Law, Ice-T, NWA, JJ Fad, Young MC, Digital Underground, Oaktown's 357, MC Hammer, and Eazy-E all came together to form the supergroup, the West Coast Rap All-Stars.
I'm King News, and I come to you with the truth. The mean streets took 6 more lives overnight, all the result of gangbang stupidity. By the way, you gangsters should know, one of your victims was a 3-year-old girl. Local gang members, you still don't get it, do you?
It's straight up madness everywhere I look. Used to be a straight A student. Now he's a crook, robbing people just to smoke and shoot up. Used to have a crew cut, now he's a poop butt. Dropped out of school and he joins the neighborhood gang. Hanging on the street selling cane to his own people. Now when I say people, I mean color. You a stupid motherfucker.
Sister, since we are the mothers of this earth, it's time we start being good mothers from the birth of our children. No time for sleeping, teach them to fight and win. For the right reason, it's your time, it's your life, live it. Proud to be black, young and gifted. Lifted by the knowledge of taking the right route. Gang violence needs to be wiped out.
One and the same, everyone came in the same chains. Caught with the same aim, brain games and names change. Destroyed the black male crack jail and semi-automatic static if the crack fails. So since we all talk the same slang, stop killing my brother cause we're all from the same gang.
Don't you know we got to put our heads together?
Make the change cause we're all in the same gang.
Now as a youth, I used to get my bang on. And on the app, get my part-time slang on. Wanna
time for me was no joke, though. They knew I was crazy, so they labeled me Loco. Khakis cleaved off, half feeling sporty. Low riding and tossing up a 40. Thinking never mind that no one can handle us. The Dallas brothers never touched Los Angeles.
Being the pimps that we are, we ain't speaking of a situation that is going too far.
Here at home in the ghettos of L.A., where a young black brother's not promised to see the next day.
Cause we used to clock on the streets before we made beats,
but fools just lay and pray on the weak.
It don't depend on the color of a rag.
Cause if you got what they want, you know they're gonna take what you
cause
have.
Cause violence can only revolve from drugs and thugs and gangs that bang most times.
It's a political thing.
Yeah, a couple of spots to get popped.
And then the government wants the things to get all get stopped.
Ice-T, ripping the microphone the way I do. Listen close, my brothers, cause I'm talking to you. The problem is we got a suicidal lifestyle. Cause 90% of us are living foul and wild. I say job, you say
bad joke. I'd rather jack another brother watch the gun smoke.
Living in the fast lane, flipping like you're insane. You won't stop until your blood runs down the street drain.
Don't you know we got to put our heads together? Stop the fight.
Make the change.
Yo, we're not here to preach,
yeah,
because we're not ministers. We're telling it like it is, cause Ren and Dre is like sinister.
The reality speaks for itself when it's spoken.
A face and blood can't bring nobody for smoking.
Yo, bullets flying, mothers crying,
brothers dying,
lying in the streets, that's why we're trying to stop it from falling apart and going to waste and keeping the smile off a white face.
And brothers killing other brothers. I thought the idea was to love one another. Open up the paper to one more death. If y'all keep this up, then there'll be no one left. I try my best to set an example, saying hype lyrics over hip-hop samples. Not just to brag, I suppose, but to inform, cause I'm living in the calm before the storm.
I'm in a rage.
Oh yeah? Yo, why is that, G?
Other races, they say we act like rats in a cage. I tried to argue, but check it. Every night in the news, we prove them suckers right, and I got the blues.
America,
get busy, Humpty.
The red, the white, the blue, and the blue in the red for grips and bloods, the white for who's got you doing time. Busting caps on one another.
The underground's down for peace among brothers.
Kill a black man.
What?
Yo, what are you retarded?
Tell them, Hunk.
Yo, do you work for the Klan?
Do what you like.
Unless you like gang banging. Let's see how many brothers leave us hanging.
Kicking on the ad about a quarter to nine. All the homies getting blind in an eight ball line. Now on this tip, they started running at the lip. Jumped in the deuces and took a little trip. Hit the block about 12 on the tick. The windows went down and the nines went click. People started yelling, bodies started bailing. Bullets go flying, sending something to hell in. It's gotta stop, we don't need all the violence. Peace in the hood and I'm over the silence. We got together, not for ego or fame. We got involved cause we're all in the same game.
Unleash your easy's no sellout. And if you can't hang in the streets, then get the hell out. I'm not trying to tell you what to do. You have your own freedom of choice who to listen to. You know good from bad, fat from foul, right from wrong. Now your mother's singing that sad song.
My baby ain't never hurt nobody,
but he still got smoked at baby's party. But you're not the first or the last. You're nothing but a short story from the past. You're dead now, not number one but a zero. Take notes from Eazy-E, the violent hero.
Around 1991, while touring with the Prophet Kwame Ture, my friend Professor Z and I began a healing program for the hip-hop community called Human Educations Against Lies, H.E.A.L. Similar to the Stop the Violence movement, H.E.A.L. was also designed to curb violence and offer strategies toward the continued unity of the hip-hop community. We were joined by Kid Capri, Big Daddy Kane, Freddie Fox, LL Cool J, MC Light, Queen Latifah, Miss Melody, G Simone, DMC, Jam Master J, Salt and Pepper, Cool Mo D, Chuck D, Ziggy Marley, Shabba Ranks, Dougie Fresh, DJ Red Alert, Michael Stipe, Billy Bragg, and motion picture video directors Fab Five Freddy, Sasha Jenkins, Jonathan Demme, the late Ted Demme, and many others.
I think one of the biggest social problems is ignorance and the lack of education and the miseducation of people, of the youth.
If you get firearms in America, firearms come into America and what they do, they get in the black hands and black people kill each other, man. That's the whole, that's the main social problem. If you take the guns away, then what are we gonna kill each other with?
Drugs.
Ignorance, you know how some people believe that racial problems stem from black to white to black, you know. Racial injustice really has no face.
Heal yourself.
your hands one time. Come on, clap your hands, clap your hands. Come on, just clap your hands, clap your hands. Everybody just hear yourself. Come on, heal, heal, heal yourself. Come on, everybody just hear yourself. Come on, everybody go side to side. Keep going, come on.
What has happened is due to years and years and years of stereotypes, lies, miseducation, things like Christopher Columbus discovered America, things like the war that was just fought over in Iraq and Iran is over, things like that. We, at an organization called Human Education Against Lies, believe that these stereotypes and myths and not knowing people's cultures is what is making people fight and argue and kill one another. If I don't know your culture, I fail to know your achievements. I also fail to know who you are. I don't respect you, therefore I can kill you because you don't look like me. Everyone should know European history. Everyone should know African history, Asian history, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
We see that a lot of the problems that currently claim to be the main problems, like drugs, gangs, family problems, education, actually it's a big lie. The number one problem in the world is that people are being lied to about what the situation is, what the problem is.
The record itself, I'm really impressed by, because projects like this, not only do we educate children, but it betters us as rappers, you know, doing positive things.
I got involved with the H.E.A.L. Project by means of KRS and Miss Melody. They called me up, asked me to do a piece in it. I could write about anything I wanted to, whatever I had a problem with in this society or in this world. I could write about it, and that's what I did.
KRS-One ran up on my man, DMC, you know what I'm saying? He said he wanted to put us in this H.E.A.L., Human Education Against Lies, you know what I'm saying? Because when they did their last thing, you know what I mean, self-destruction, they kind of like left Run DMC out, you know what I'm saying? So I felt like that might have been a self-destruction amongst ourselves in the rap game, being that we're so large as we is.
You know what I'm saying? Because the devil be lying, man.
So we said, yo, everybody was kicking it. We heard what everybody's talking about. We said, we might as well kick it for AIDS because black people nowadays don't think they can catch AIDS. So DMC came up with this rhyme about AIDS.
I got involved with the H.E.A.L. movement because of KRS-One. I was already with the Stop the Violence movement, and I was invited to partake in little innuendo type thing. So I decided, what better way to come across the way you want to, because it gives you the option of rhyming about what you want to rhyme about.
My part in the song is heal yourself, you have to heal yourself. And that works, you know, in every aspect, you know, man and woman being a three-dimensional being, both mental, physical and spiritual. And in each case, you know, we need to build that, you know, together.
I got in the project from KRS-One. He came to me and said, Capri, you need to come to the studio and get your voice on this record. We were all getting together, we put this record together called Human Education Against Lies, H.E.A.L. Right? It's a record about human culture. It's like things that everybody spoke about, things that went on in their life. You know what I'm saying? It's like little stories, little things that you could learn from. And I just put my little big mouth part in it, you know what I'm saying?
As you can plainly see, we have the Demi.
Two Demi.
Two Demi, actually.
One.
They're twins. Thank you. Is that a
compliment? I had met KRS-One through Yo, and we'd wanted to work together on something. So KRS-One brought the H.E.A.L. project to me. He said, I've got this great video. Think about directing it. Listen to it. What do you think? I listened to it. I loved it. And I gave a copy to Jonathan, who was equally impressive, not only with KRS-One's earlier work, but with that particular project. And he said, let's do something together. I said, great, because we'd wanted to do something together for a while. And so we got together, put a concept together, got Fab Five Freddy involved, and Pam Jenkins involved, and the four of us are directing it. And we took the song and split it up into four different areas. And each of us is responsible for a different area, but yet we're all putting input into the entire project with Chris.
I started trying to get in touch with KRS-One several months ago because I love his writing very much, and I'd love to make a movie with him someday, either as a writer, as an actor, or whatever. And eventually, through those efforts to talk to him about that, the subject of this video came up, and Chris invited me to become part of it. That excited me a lot because I think that the H.E.A.L. project is a tremendously important project. Human Education Against Lies. The way I interpret that is it's education against the kind of lies that have been institutionalized in the kind of history we're taught in the public school system here in America, which essentially gives a very racist, European-based version of history. And it excludes the importance and the achievements and the struggle of black people in America. So I'm all for, I want my children to be educated against those lies. And I hope that Chris's project goes a long way towards counterbalancing and influencing what gets taught in the public schools eventually.
He'll, to me, means that in this day and age, we as a human race have to put aside our insecurities, our hatred, our lack of understanding or respect for our fellow man, woman, and kind of come together and heal ourselves inwardly as well as on the outside.
With the situation with black Americans in America today, anything involving the word heal has to be positive. And of course, when KRS-One is at the helm of this mighty aircraft carrier that we're all involved in, then it's going to be a victorious mission. And, you know, everybody is being very conscious, being very aware, and kind of helping to inspire people that come from neighborhoods just like this one you see here to do the right thing and to know that there's hope within yourself.
Still doing the making of, and we just want to know how's it going, you know, so you're live on
hand. Well, everything's just fine. Listen, take one shot up there real quick. Just go straight up. You see that? That is what time of day it really is here. That is called a steady cam. And what we're doing is we're not editing this video at all. This is a straight shot. He's going to be floating through the sky on that crane over there, filming various recording artists' due date piece.
Kane is going to, if you follow me, you can see that he's going to be down here, down the stairs. And essentially, he'll be talking about when he was a young boy and how his mother used to say not to do drugs. And we'll have a little boy that will play the younger Kane. And in the background behind him, it's sort of like a surrealist shot of this little boy playing with a marionette puppet. As Kane begins singing his lines, he'll walk up the stairs and basically he'll end right here.
Mama said, don't do crack and smoke, you know, cause it'll make your nose grow like Pinocchio. Since I was only 15, I had to listen to what was said from a parent who's a Christian.
We just getting all the tweaks, we getting everything set up.
Oh, yeah.
I just had to go over a few things for Freddie Fox's part, cause all the directors, we love what he's doing so much. We wanted to amp it up. We got the ladies. Say hi, ladies.
Hi.
Everybody rise as I present to a jet black crowd what it's like to be black and proud in a world where white is right, but not tonight. This is a black man's mic.
I heard a sister say she don't like darker shades of black on a man cause that's whack, but to my light-skinned sister, can't you tell? It's just the surface of a dark, deep well. And how could you prefer to be with those that sprayed you with guns and hoses and never put roses on the graves of the slaves that they treated like dirt after all that hard work? And basically, basically it is, you know, that's kind of true because if anybody knows Fox, they know that I'm definitely a ladies man. And if I see a nice looking lady, I'm definitely gonna try to speak on it, you know? And one day I was rolling with a buddy of mine and we seen a nice little young lady walking down the street. She was a lighter complexion type of lady, you know? And my friend spoke to her and her friend said she don't like dark skinned guys. So I kind of take a lot of things that really happen in reality and put them on wax, you know? So you felt you had to heal that situation? Yeah, so I healed the situation by speaking on it in a situation like this. And I see a lot of little kids around, you know, they screaming and they jumping around and they're on break from school, you know? And it's a shame that they have to go back in there and read in some social studies book that some white guy did this and pilgrims did that, and you know, when there's really more to it, you know what I mean? And it's not about being prejudiced or being racist or anything. It's just about understanding the truth and reality of the human, the man, black man, you know?
So Fab, while I got you a moment alone, why don't you tell people about your part in the video and what it consists of and all of that? You know, you
can just start. Do I need to hold the mic?
You know, I have to. I can boom you.
Whatever. Well, it consists of me being involved as one of the four directors. And the segment that I'm directing involves Freddie Fox. It was supposed to involve Freddie Fox and LL Cool J. Unfortunately, he's not around. So what we're going to be doing is for the segment, a Jeep is going to pull into the frame. It's going to come out of the previous section, which Pam Jenkins is directing with Big Daddy Kane. This red Jeep right here, as a matter of fact, if you can whip over and get a quick shot of it, that Jeep's going to pull into frame. Freddie Fox is going to start his rap. He's going to get out of the Jeep, walk towards the Steadicam, drop down, deliver his lyrics real strong, and then the camera's going to pan over
And I'm going to also be involved in the next segment, which is supposed to be LL segment, with several homeboys in the neighborhood.
Just go with the flow, man. You know what I'm saying?
Go with the flow.
No problem. No problem for this.
Don't really...
Yo.
Don't really play it into the camera. Just deal with it while we're doing it. We're like,
oh,
yeah, that's it, buddy.
Heal yourself. You got to heal yourself. Heal yourself, oh. In elementary, White had the Jordache look, like me and any other kid who cared about books. But then I got wise, and I began to listen to the whack teachers in the wick-whack system. My mother put me in where I used to shoot them, which means black school in Swahili.
School, extracurricular, you know, where I think it should be different classes or added classes to teach you, you know, teach you other types of things, you know. Why don't they have Swahili as a language? Why is it always French and Spanish, you know? Stuff like that.
Come on, lights!
The portion that I'm involved with begins when MC Light comes on screen and follows through to Queen Latifah and delivers back to KRS-One. So I'm in very good company there, and I'm excited because they're all artists that I admire a lot.
Jane was never taught her life was worth something, but when people don't try to improve, it makes me want to hurt some. You want to be somebody and be a standout, but got your hand out. Oh, you're broke? I guess it's all to your man's house.
I chose to write about, you know, a woman who wasn't taught that she was worth something, but never tried to improve herself. You know, she treated herself like a common garden tool instead of uplifting herself personally. And she depended on a man, you know, for money and whatever else, when she should have depended on herself first and then joined them if they wanted to do that. So that's what I wrote about.
You know, you guys.
Let me tell you, Latifah, you've been a fabulous asset to this project.
You know, whenever you come to our home, we feel that it is thrice blessed. Once because we know you're coming, twice because you're there, thrice effing leave.
Thank you.
It's beautiful.
Oh, man, this is human education against lies. You better know the flavor, kid.
Human education against lies tries to open the eyes of humanity before it dies. Black and white ain't the real fight. That's the only thing the media hypes.
The only solution is organized revolution. That's the only solution. But people are afraid of that word revolution, so we like to use the word change. If you like change, you have to go out. There's two types of people in the world. People who will wait for the violence to stop, or people who want to stop the violence. If you want to wait for the violence to stop, well, you'll wait, and you'll allow yourself to be a victim of negativity for the rest of your life, waiting for it to stop. There are, in fact, the revolutionaries who are looking for a change and willing to make a change. Those people, ultimately, are rich, wealthy, influential men and women who feel as though after they leave the ghetto situation, they can't even come back. They have no need to come back. The solution is to gain economic power and then turn that economics into heal videos, self-destruction videos, so on. There's a whole networking. In addition to that, there are such individuals like Mr. Ted Demi here. You don't know this, really, but the reason you probably know rap music is because of this gentleman right here. Before him, rap really was just a Saturday, Friday thing on the radio, which was still cool, but this gentleman here, behind the scenes people, broadened it even more. Too bad he's a hoe.
Ah.
So, I'll be out of here. See ya.
And just when you thought you knew everything there was to know, you didn't know anything about this. Tell him, Melody. Daddy's home every day since he lost his job. His new line of work is now beating up mom. Mom is scared. She doesn't know what to do. Her beautiful skin is now black and blue.
I think that the social problem of today is the fact that no one wants to be the consciousness of anything. Everybody wants to be a chain reaction. This one does this, so you do that. And everybody's going around, so it's a vicious circle. And we all run around biting each other's butts. That's what I think is the social problem.
Specifically, I'm working on the Ms. Melody area and the Run DMC area in the Kid Capri finale, which is, you know, Melody's coming out of her house, and we see this domestic problem going on behind it. We're going to capture that. And then we wanted to get the entire block involved in it because they've been really cooperative and great. So they're going to be all in the background for this entire thing to get them a chance to feel like they're involved, not just from, you know, just from letting us be on their block, but being in the video. And Run DMC is just taking it. They're actually it's DMC and Jay.
DMC came up with this rhyme about AIDS, and we kicked it to Chris. Chris said, yo, y'all like on. It. Human education against lies, you know what I'm
for
saying?
For all the girls and all the guys.
Check it out, check, no disrespect.
For each and every member of the opposite sexes.
Yes.
The message is, and I sent some. We never knew where the poison came from.
Yo, we rapping on hills, so we don't be like to mention.
Acquired immune deficiency syndrome.
AIDS.
We're here to make you get wise.
Human education against lies.
Human Education Against Lies is an organization where you see where the money's gonna go. I think that's the most important thing. A lot of organizations, they have a fundraiser to raise money for so-and-so, and then after the fundraiser is over, that's the end, on to the next benefit. But this thing, you're gonna see what's gonna happen. You're gonna see the millions of free books that's gonna be given out to youth off the money that's made from HEAL. You're gonna see all the word warfare and all of the feeding hungry homeless people around the city and all the projects that we have coming up. So that's the most important thing about HEAL. You get to see where the money goes.
The HEAL record, which is the first single out on this album, it's a record called HEAL Yourself, features MC Light, Harmony, Big Daddy Kane, Light, Latifah, Freddie Fox, Run DMC, myself, KRS-One, your television should be glowing right about now, Run DMC, and of course Kid Capri and Miss Melody. And also, let me say that in addition to that, we had third bass on the record, but due to contractual reasons, we had to edit them off. But they're still down in the project in spirit. Now, when we dropped this album, we raised maybe $1 million, $800,000. That money goes into the book. See the plan? The album sells, the book goes to you for free, forcing the educational system to take a look at what they are teaching you. We believe that before you are a race, an occupation, or a religion, you're a human being. And that's basically what HEAL is all about. Thank you and goodbye. Please, no pictures, please.
Come on, everybody clap your hands one time. Come on, clap your hands, clap your hands. Come on, just clap your hands, clap your hands. Everybody just hear yourself. Come on, heal, heal, hear yourself. Come on, everybody just hear yourself. Come on, everybody go side to side. Keep going, come on.
Mama said, don't do crack and smoke, you know, cause it'll make your nose grow like Pinocchio. Since I was only 15, I had to listen to what was said from a parent who's a Christian. I went to school and saw all my friends do it, but I said no, cause I ain't want my nose to grow. They started tripping on me, busting and flipping on me, so I had to front and say, yo, truth slipping on me. I started smoking to prove I'm an adult. Now it's a habit, but is it all my fault? I wish my mother had told me the truth, cause now I'm all based out, my dope.
Everybody rise as I present to a jet black crowd what it's like to be black and proud in a world where white is right, but not tonight. This is a black man's mic. I heard a sister say she don't like darker shades of black on a man, cause that's whack. But to my light skin sister, can't you tell? You're just the surface of a dark deep well. And how could you prefer to be with those that spray you with guns and hoses and never put roses on the graves of the slaves that they treated like dirt after all that hard work?
Clap your hands to the beat, come on, and just clap your hands to the beat.
WBDP Live, special report, special report.
HEAL, Human Education Against Lies, is the forward movement, moving for the only solution, which is revolution.
A thousand points of light.
Lies!
They're not taught this in school, so we supplement the educational system. The human being's purpose is to serve humanity.
The war was a success.
We don't want it now!
Jordache look, like me and any other kid who cared about books. But then I got wise, and I began to listen to the whack teachers in the wick-whack system. My mother put me in where I used to shoot, which means black school. because school is closed. There's nowhere for black youth to go to be taught by brothers and sisters. Who knows what it means to be a black child or a white teen? In the end, the youth are being mistreated, which means the world is being cheated. Dane was never taught her life was worth something. But when people don't try to improve, it makes me want to hurt some. You want to be somebody and be a standout, but got your hand out. Oh, you're broke? I guess it's on to your man's house. Brothers and sisters giving up the bar. Today it's easy not to father, it's too hard. They call us skeezers, and you prove it to the worst. Honey, you have to earn the right to say it's ladies first.
Oh man, this is human education against lies. You better know the flavor, kid.
Human education against lies tries to open the eyes of humanity before it dies. Black and white ain't the real fight. That's the only thing the media hypes. The real fight of these major corporations holding back on real education. Before you're a color, first you're human. Teaching humanity is what we're doing.
And just when you thought you knew everything there was to know, you didn't know anything about this. Tell him, Melody.
Daddy's home every day since he lost his job. His new line of work is now beating up mom. Mom is scared, she doesn't know what to do. Her beautiful skin is now black and blue. She used to cry, now she's back in the pen. A human war between woman and man.
Melody, kick it free and
JMJ all the way.
Yo, human education against lies.
To all the girls and to all the guys,
get paid.
Check.
No disrespect to each and every member of the opposite sexes.
Yes, it is the messages, and I sent some. We never knew where the poison came from.
Yo, we rapping on hills, so we don't be like to mention.
Acquired immune deficiency syndrome.
AIDS, we're here to make you get wise.
Human education against lies.
Clap your hands to the beat. Come on and just clap your hands to the beat. Let me see you just clap your hands to the beat. Come on and just clap your hands to the beat. Oh man, there go my main man, Kenny Parker. He on the side.
The main point was that technology seemed to be overwhelming the concept of civilization. We noticed that more emphasis was being placed upon technological innovation than upon knowledge of one's human abilities. We called for healing and balance. Our campaign promoted the idea that before you are a race, a religion, or an occupation, you are a human being. Yes, these tools are very important to the presentation and sustainment of hip-hop's activity and history in the world, but again, hip-hop in and of itself is a human skill produced by the human spirit. This we must never forget. And even though most of us are already totally dependent upon an outside technological system of some sort to live, pay bills, and eat, it is always liberating to know that hip-hop as a human skill offers some relief from mainstream technological employment dependency. Such knowledge keeps us and our children's children free and entrepreneurial, well-grounded upon what is real. This was some of what H.E.A.L. was all about. However, as I began to really investigate the nature of my being and why I am who I am and why I do what I do, I realized that I am what I am doing and being right now. I realized that I was not just performing the artistic elements of hip-hop, but that I was hip-hop itself. I am hip-hop. I realized that hip-hop was not over there somewhere, but that I was hip-hop itself, and so was everyone else who participated in hip-hop in some way. My eye was opened. 2 years later, in 1994, I began to flesh out the I Am Hip-Hop philosophy, as well as the science of rap. In the same year, Afrika Bambaataa, Kool DJ Herc, Crazy Legs, Grand Wizard Theodore, Daddy-O, Mr. Wiggles, TC Islam, Teddy Ted, and Special K, Kevy Kev, Harry Allen, Jacqueline Hines, DJ Kenny Parker, Hakeem Green, X-Men, and several other artists, founders, journalists, and grassroots activists of that era all came together for the first time in hip-hop's history at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture in Harlem, New York, to discuss the creation and preservation of hip-hop as a real culture. Harry Allen, the media assassin, stood before the conscious hip-hop community of 1994 and said,
Good afternoon, everybody. I can't begin to speak or claim to speak on behalf of hip-hop and the culture which has been built over these last few decades without giving respect to my predecessor, Africa Bambaataa. And to all the rest of my brothers and sisters who are here on behalf of this art form, which is blooming, growing, under attack, I guess whatever adjective you want to put against it, hip-hop is, you know, ducking bullets in many cases. My name is Harry Allen, hip-hop activist and media assassin. I respect your time, so I'm going to speak briefly, and afterwards, KRS-One will take the rest of the meeting, but he was gracious enough to let me start this, so let's start this. My presentation is entitled Black Art, Lost, Stolen, or Strayed. Now, I'm going to ask you a very simple question, and after I do, I want you to raise your hand if your response is yes, but I only want you to do this after I tell you to, and only if your answer is yes. Because if your answer is yes, you're the person that I want to be speaking to this afternoon. Here's the question. How many people believe that hip-hop as an art form and as an aggressive form of black art and imagination should have a home? Now, don't raise your hand yet. How many people believe that there should be a place where hip-hop is archived, a place where the history is available through booklets or pamphlets or maybe even online by computer? How many people believe that there's a place, should be a place where hip-hop teaches and gives people information that they can use for hip-hop and for other things in their lives? How many believe there should be a place, a society, an academy, if you will, where awards are given for excellence in the field? How many people here believe that there should be a place where the records and the videos and the magazines and the photographs and the charts and the posters and the articles and on and on and on and on are kept for the future and preserved so that future generations will be able to understand what this form was, why it came to be, and why we were here? Now, if you believe this, raise your hand and keep it up. Now, keep it up, because I want to ask you one more question. If you really do believe this, what have you done today, or even in the last week, to make sure this happens? Ask yourself this question. What is the proof of your belief? Okay. Put your hands down. Black art is lost, stolen, or strayed. You know, it's been said that if you go to the great African art museums of Europe, or even in this country, and we can talk about the Berlin Art Museum or many of the other art museums, and if you look at the African art in those museums, and if you look at the dates attached to the art, by taking those dates and taking the art where it's from and plotting it on a map, you can essentially outline the path of European conquest of the African continent, like a flow chart, like a graph, all throughout the last century. Now, is this your fate? Is this what's going to become of you? If you're a hip-hop artist, or if you're an industry professional, or if you're a person who's just concerned about this form that you've seen made out of nothing and turned into a billion-dollar business right before your very eyes in your lifetime, is this what's going to happen to you? Is this your fate, to basically be a marker, your work a marker to conquest, to the destruction of yourself? I'd like to refer to another example real quickly. What I have in my hand, marked up in red, is an article that was clipped from November of 1993 in Billboard. It's headlined, Library of Congress to Digitize Bernstein. Now, this appeared, ironically, the same day that the Billboard rap issue appeared, where they have their celebration of hip-hop and what it is and everything. I'm just going to read a few paragraphs from this article. The Library of Congress landed a musical gold mine November 8th when the estate of Leonard Bernstein decided to donate his personal and professional archives to the institution. Now, the library plans to share that wealth electronically. Now, as you may know, Leonard Bernstein is an American composer, West Side Story, I guess Porgy and Bess, a whole bunch of, you know, very well renowned for his work, and he died last year. donates his work to the Library of Congress. The Bernstein materials, which include more than 200 hours of film and video programs and 1,000 hours of recordings, as well as such documents as unpublished musical sketches and lyrics and original music manuscripts, will be used to launch a planned electronic archive accessible to the public by computer. They're going to call this the Leonard Bernstein Multimedia Archives. Under such a system, all of the materials in the Bernstein collection, audio, video, and print, will be digitized or translated to the digital language for storage on a central database. In this form, the information can be accessed from a remote computer via modem. Once established, the Bernstein Multimedia Archive will serve as a model for a larger, long-range multimedia project, the library says. Now, why couldn't hip-hop music have something like this? Why couldn't a form that generates $1 billion in record sales alone have something like this if it wants to? Why can't a billion-dollar art form have anything it wants? That's a question I'm asking you today because, well, respect to Herc, Cool Herc. We are now at a stage in the development of this form where, unlike the situation when people like Cool Herc and Africa Bambaataa were inventing this art out of our own black genius, we're now at a stage where there are people who are professionals in diverse areas, who know things, who have information. We're at a stage where Wu-Tang Clan can make an album for almost nothing, distribute it themselves, get picked up by a major, and then generate 500,000 copies in sales, millions and millions of dollars in revenue. But how much of that comes back to hip-hop? That's the question we have to answer, I guess, or be run over, or be left as monuments to our own destruction. I got tired of wondering about the answers to questions like this, so I came up with my own answer. I started an organization. It's called the Rhythm Cultural Institute. The agenda of the organization is to capture, keep for the future, aggressively define, and widely expand the discussion and definition of hip-hop music as a culture so that it can enrich us and so that it can make us better and so that we can get something from it besides music and good times. Now, the organization is for the most part unknown, which is the way I prefer it to be. I think it's better to let your work speak for you, and we're doing some things. We're getting some things done. Recently, we had a PSA produced, which was paid for by Def Jam Recordings, and it debuted during the Source Awards. We also had an ad, which was donated and which ran in their program, a copy of that, which I have here. You might remember seeing it if you went to the Source Awards or looked at the program. The board is formed by myself, David D. Cook from KMEL in Oakland, and Mary Kay Penn, who you probably haven't heard of, but she's a scholar, an anthropologist based here, the only anthropologist who, when I met, knew the lyrics to "I Know You Got Soul" by Rakim. So I, you know, definitely knew I had to have her down. We're small. We're small, but we're politically astute, technologically savvy, legally and contractually curious. And obviously, this is a message, and this is an idea that has that people understand and want to be part of. Recently, we got a grant from the New York Folklore Society upon application, and what this money will do will pay to have an archivist, a person whose job it is to take history, wrap it up, and make it last 500 years, come here to New York and sit down in front of a group like yourself or others and tell you, if you take this process of archiving, preserving, something that's usually appointed to mummies and, you know, Renaissance art, and you pointed at hip-hop, the art of our very hands, how would you do it? How would you make it happen? You know, as well, we have plans to have a legislative aide from Albany come down here to New York City and tell you how, by using our juice, our power, our connections, we can get the money to do such a thing and implement such a vision. The fact is that hip-hop artists especially are people who have a lot of connections politically, are popular, have above average income many, but do not use their political connections, do not use their influence, do not use their influence to make things happen for the form. We're unfortunately divided to a great extent, and hopefully this will change. motto for black people should be build or be killed.
I've been attending meetings hosted by BAM for this maybe not exact same theme, but the theme of unifying hip-hop as a culture, unifying artists, and having them organize in a fashion where they can control their political power, control their economic power, their creative power, et cetera, et cetera. What has happened is that over the past few years, BAM would get everyone together. We'd all come in a room, we'd say, yeah, yeah, yeah. Next day, we're gone, and nothing happens. Mm. This has happened over and over again. I've seen artists who will scream, BAM, Zulu Nation, Zulu, yeah, Zulu. And then the anniversary comes around, they're nowhere to be found. Mm. In my opinion, you know, I feel as though that in the scheme of African thought, we always paid respects to our elders, and not that you're an elder, BAM, but we always paid respect to the people who have come before us, meaning that we could not have been in the situation that we're in unless we at least show acknowledgement. Sometimes that acknowledgement is shown through money. Sometimes that acknowledgement is shown through just basic respect. Just, yo, I recognize, and that's it. Today, the hip-hop community is dying because we fail to have this kind of respect. And it's not a matter of any of us going and saying, okay, Afrika Bambaataa is God. Cool Herc is God. We gotta kneel to these icons, et cetera, et cetera. It's not on that level. It's on the level of before we decided to pick up a mic, pick up a turntable. Mm. Matter of fact, before we knew what it was, these gentlemen were out there doing this and doing that. And we do it differently now. They did it one way, Flash does it another way, Theodore does it another way. Herc does it one way. Then you got Run DMC and LL, and they do it their way. Then it's Eric B and Rakim and KRS-One, Biz Markie, and they do it their way. Now we're coming into a new phase in hip-hop, which has to do now with the world is doing it their way. And the difference between what has happened then and what is happening now is that for the first time in hip-hop history, hip-hop is no longer a New York-based thing. And I don't say that to say that it isn't. I'm saying that to say that the reality of what I look at now is that when you go to Japan, the Japanese kids are, I'm hip-hop. I'm hip-hop. You are not. I am. You're in my country now. And you can't tell me that you're not. And that you can't tell me that I'm not. Mm-hmm. You go to Germany, this, that, and the other. My California, Oakland, the South, Miami, et cetera, et cetera. My point is that hip-hop is running away from us before our very eyes. And I used to always wonder years ago, I used to always say, wow, what was Chubby Checker and Chuck Berry and the Supremes, what were they doing to now have like a Nirvana? And if you see a black rock group now, you're amazed. Right. Wow, a black rock, Living Color, wow, they're black and they do rock. That's like an amazement, when in actuality, again, I don't have to go into that, but we again are the originators of that art form as well. So my point here in starting, just press send, the point here in starting this discussion is that, number one, what I see going on in hip hop is that it's the same thing that went on in rock and roll, but we have a chance to stop it. We're allowing things to happen. We're just allowing certain things to just happen. And we're just watching them and saying, yeah, that's small, that really don't affect us. That's small too, that really don't affect us. Then, as much as I respect John Schechter and The Source for what they've done in rap, now we have John Schechter doing an award, giving us awards for our creativity. Now, let me be very clear in what I'm saying, because this is no way a demise or a disrespect to the source or any magazine for that matter. Could have been any magazine. But the point here is that everyone is giving themselves the ability to define our creativity. And the point here of this discussion, or the point that I'd like to interject, is to, for once and for all, define hip-hop. Hip-hop as the lifestyle, as the energy, as the way of life, as the organized way of life. And do it in a sense whereas we can put together a pamphlet or something. I don't want to call it rules, I don't want to call it regulations, but I mean, I guess during this conversation we'll come up with some name for it, but it should clearly define, and this is not a process that's going to take just today. This is the beginning. We're going to go on and on, and the purpose for you all to be here is to get several ideas. Ideas as to what you think this certain question, how this question should be answered. If someone else disagrees, we should give everyone a chance to speak, of course. But ideas are created out of argument, out of this is what I think it is. Why do you think it's like that? Maybe it could be like this, et cetera, et cetera. So just to start it off, this book that I'm proposing is to be given to every record company and A&R person in the entire planet, the whole world. There's only a couple of thousand record companies that seem to be controlling our entire fate in their hand. There's only a couple of hundred magazines, only a couple of thousand television shows. If some sort of document or book or pamphlet can be put together that says, this is what hip-hop is and this is what we think it should be. This book is not something that will last forever. It's like, it might even have to be revised every 2 or 3 years. Mm. This is what hip-hop is now in 1997. This is what it is now in this, that, and the other. We're documenting it now in 1994 based on not having documented it since its conception. We have a whole broad range of people who have history in their minds, who have certain thoughts and are pushing the forum forward. And this is the purpose, actually, of one of the purposes of why you're here. Let me just end off and say also that this book, in my mind, will be backed up by force. And when I say force, it doesn't always mean physical, but it means that too. But it doesn't always mean that. It means political force. In other words, there's a point to make to the A&R people who are signing rap, the guys giving in their tapes. How, if you're going to give in a tape and say, I'm in the rap, you have to define yourself. Are you going to be a rap artist or are you going to be a hip-hop artist? Because if you say you're going to be a hip-hop artist, well, this little book here put together by the minds of people in hip-hop is what you should know. This will also weed out who's not down and who really is. In addition to that, we won't have these problems that hip hop is having because of rap artists. So this is the main focus of what I'm saying here today.
And we began our session by rearranging our chairs into a circle. When the cipher was complete, KRS continued.
All right. Well, let me start it off with question number one. Question number one being, what in our minds is the most important aspect to preserving the culture of hip hop? And when I say what in our minds is that. Is in this day and age, is the most powerful means of preserving the culture, politics, meaning you have to hip-hop needs more people in professional life, or does it mean that's going to hinder us? Matter of fact, I'll start it off like this. In our opinion, can you be a professional in hip-hop?
Good question.
I don't think so, because I think hip-hop is a way of life. It's a culture. How do you become a professional in your way of life unless you live and go to the afterlife?
What about someone like, say like Jews, for instance, just say. That's a personal belief. Like, say they would wear their... I'm talking about Orthodox Jews. They would wear their yarmulke, their whole thing, to work. Mm. And when you deal with them, you have to see they're Jewish. And you have to see, we're in a different circumstance.
But Brother Chris, being Jewish isn't like wearing a yarmulke and all that. That's your ways in action. It's like brothers and sisters that live hip-hop. It's a way of life.
For y'all to deal with the industry in hip-hop, y'all gonna have to be organized, because you're dealing with some devious, evil people who've been robbing people since the 50s with the doo-wop groups, the same things in the 60s, same thing they're doing with hip-hop. A lot of the rap groups don't know about their mechanical rights, their royalties, their licensing. You can have a cover over here that's one cover, and in Europe or in some other Latin America would be a whole different cover, or they might even take your picture off. You gotta know about cable vision. You gotta be in tune with what's happening with the future. There's so many different things, like we need to get into professionalism and cable vision, because it's gonna be 500 TV channels coming on, and they're gonna need music, programming, video shows for this. You got to be organized, you gotta have discipline, structure, and you're gonna have to have professionalism, because that's what it did to take hip hop away from y'all. Because the hip hop community itself was not organized. So meaning now, the first death of hip hop it took away was the vinyl. Meaning they got rid of the DJ. They didn't speak to the black or Latino community and saying, do you want to get rid of your turntables or vinyl? They say, boom, it's out, CDs is in, cassettes is in, and that's what happened. And we just go along with the program. A couple of us might argue and put on our record, we want vinyl. They give, you know, your little bits to make you happy and shit, and then they might throw you a little money to shut the hell up. You got a lot of sellouts in the industry in hip-hop. The only way we could do is dealing by an organized meeting of the minds, and it can't be this one meeting. We have to go down many meetings down there. It could be a year, 2 year, whatever, until we get this whole thing structured, like hip-hop union organization.
And keep in mind that this discussion is taking place in 1994, before the internet and at the dawn of compact discs, satellite television, and digital radio. Afrika Bambaataa foresaw all of what is going on today and warned us of what was to come. Only the wise listen.
See, we got to start working with the brothers or sisters that wants to do, be a doer of the word. The ones that want to do, you know, leave them on the side, because when the time comes around and the ones that's all into this material shit, they will get on the bandwagon once they see something materialistic to them. That's how many people just join a lot of unions. You think, The Federation of Teachers waited for everybody to come together before they could deal with the Board of Education, or the unions that deal with construction workers, like the brothers, the black and Latino construction workers. They didn't start to say, the whites are not giving us no jobs working with construction. They got together and they went out there and start taking jobs or demanding their jobs. And the same way we're going to have to deal with the industry, because you're messing with some real devious people that's robbing the shit out of a lot of these artists, even the ones that make crazy money in the industry, they're still getting involved. If you want to sit down and really talk to them in truth. You know, you don't want no brother that's gonna get in the limelight and show, I got my cars, all the young ladies, I got my house and stuff. You know, really sit down and check with them how much is they really getting, or is the industry getting billions of money, or like Wu-Tang, if they sold so many, or how much money or percentage that they getting from the record companies.
You know, see, the thing is that we can't, our only alternative, if we don't make it, we all live, you know, I can't say we all live hip-hop, I personally do, but my only alternative, if I can't make it with a dance company or whatever, if I can't dance no more, it can't only be to scramble.
Right.
That's the point. My only alternative can't be my hustling. It has to be like something solid right there, bam. All right, cool. All right, I can't dance no more. You know, I can still dance, but you know, if I can't dance no more, bam, we got a dance company going out. We have Get Original Dance Productions, and we're hiring from within the community, okay? So we're doing this. We've set up a base for people who don't have the money to go take ballet or jazz or whatever. And that's already been taken away from us anyway, because those are all original African art forms. All right, now, what we're doing is we're just like saying, okay, boom, these brothers out here don't have the money to join those things, and let's get them something, let's get them involved with something that's more cultural, more meaningful to them instead of wearing some tights. You know, if you, that's your own prerogative if a brother want to wear tights. But I know the sisters that dance with us that want to get busy on some lock and pop and b-boy, whatever you want to, you know, whatever they want to do, and we take them on tour. So we have to just create these other outlets, and if you can't do it, you have to be able to bring people on that can still do it. And it's like those brothers who produced Vanilla Ice, those black people that produced them, okay? They made money on Vanilla Ice. I think that's dope. I mean, it's just chuckable, but
I think,
you know.
A real important aspect to preserving hip-hop, I mean, I believe, is getting people to find esteem in hip-hop. I've been teaching public schools for the last 4 years, and the one thing I noticed in teaching social studies is that the kids didn't see their immediate society as worth something studying. So things that I would do is I would say, okay, we're going to study hip-hop. Hip-hop is a society of people. You interact with one another. We're going to study the ways in which you interact, the ways in which your society manifests itself, the dance, the music, the hairstyles, the clothes, the fashion. Then I flipped it and said, well, let's see who makes money off of it. I started bringing magazines in. I bought The Word Up in and the Rap Masters. Then I bought The Source in and The Vibe. And as we got higher in levels of getting across messages, we saw where the most money was going. I said, well, why is that? You know, we have to start seeing our community as something to have esteem in. In doing that, we define it. Like I said, I've been teaching school for the last 4 years. This is how I dress. When I put my locks in, I had a little friction with my boss, the principal. When I broke it down, I said, look, my locks is an expression of my culture, who I am as an African man. If there's a problem with me wearing my locks, then we'll have to take this further. If Jews can wear the locks off the side of their face and not see any feedback, or wear a yarmulke, I should be able to wear my hair that way. But it's getting people to say, yo, you're worth something, and if you're worth something, stand up for yourself. We as hip-hop community are worth something, we need to stand up for self.
One thing that I realized, a lot of people here define hip-hop in their own way, and I think that's a mistake. You see, in order for hip-hop to be a culture, you have to have every element. Culture is not just rap. And I think even though we hear it all the time, a lot of us, it don't sink in. See, culture is art, music, dance, the way you eat, the way you dress, the way you talk, the way you walk, the whole nine. Now, I can sit here and say, yeah, we all this and blah, blah, but I'm not sure, because how many people here know how to do graffiti or respect a graffiti writer or hire a graffiti writer to do their album cover as opposed to, you know, whoever the hell, and how many people here really truly believe in b-boying, that hire b-boys, give b-boys props, you know what I'm saying, as an original hip-hop dance, as well as the new school dances, because it ain't really happening. There ain't no connection there. Well, and I feel if we're going to make that connection, all right, we got to take every top rap artist, which to me means recording artist production, because all they know how to do is go into a studio and record, but can they get on stage and rock the crowd? If they can't, why are they on stage? Back in the days, MCs needed to be heard. The dancers needed to be seen. The art needs to be seen. You know what I'm saying? We got to get back to the original cultural and that mentality of the whole art form. Once we get everybody culturally based, then we can move. But right now, we're not treating it as a culture. We're treating it as a commodity. And when you treat it as a commodity, you're going to lose it.
Well, just to follow back on what he just said, I think first off, we have to get rid of the hypocrisy in this room. And with no offense to anybody in here, but for all the old school people in here, I'm Jacqueline Hines from Hip Hop Incorporation that called when first came up with the idea of museum, Hall of Fame turned into archive. I mean, these are things that I sit here and I'm offended and I'm saddened that you would say, you know, you gotta be certain, you have to be this in hip hop, you gotta do this in hip hop. Anybody that comes to me and says, I want to preserve the black woman for what it is today. I'm giving my all in all to that project. all I said is that come be a part of it, be on the board, participate. Instead, what I get is not people trying to assist in a museum that already has a provisional charter, that's already established, that's already getting the, that has already established all the groundwork. What I get is, oh, let me get an idea off of this so I could be first, or let me come to meetings and talk about what people have to be in hip hop. That's like saying black. A lot of people look at me and they say, well, you're not black because of your hair texture. Well, let me tell you, I'm more black than half of y'all in this room, and I know more about my culture than half of y'all. So to define people on the basis of how they look, well, you can't be hip hop, you can't be black, that's just bullshit. You have to define people by heart and where they gonna put their time. I don't know too many people that's going broke for hip hop. I'll tell you right now, I'm broke because of hip hop, and I'm getting into more expenses because of hip hop. And when people talk about they want to do something for hip hop, find out what their root cause is. Find out if they want to be the first. I don't care. There could be 5 museums up tomorrow about hip hop, but my museum will still be established because I know the concept and the thought and the heart that I have in it. It will always be successful. It's just you have to find out what they want out of the project. Is it they want to be first? Is it money they want? What is it that they want? Because I see a lot of times in hip hop, it's just that people don't want to assist other people because they want to be the first to have it. They want to have the money from it. I mean, I think that if you're going for money, I think every society needs an economic base, but that does not mean you have to drive a Benz. If we all live in the same community, we all eat, we live, and we happy, and we live in the life we're supposed to, like a village in Africa, then you don't need expensive clothes. You set your own standards. You don't have to live off of nobody else's standards.
After a brief comment by an unknown member of the Zulu Nation, Crazy Legs addressed Jacqueline Hines' remarks. Crazy Legs said,
"You know what I'm saying? You know, we missed. I think we should hit the first thing she spoke on. I think it was something more personal with certain people in here. The fact that I'll tell you straight up, when you first called me, I never heard of you in my life. And bottom line, most of the people that call me to get involved with projects, and I'm sure with certain other old school people in here, we don't know who they are. And don't forget, we were the first ones to get jerked." And we got jerked, so that means we've been getting jerked the longest. So what happens is, since that we were jerked already, people try to insult our intelligence and try to say, okay, well, let me see if I can get this person to do it, because they've done so much shit. They probably are so hard off of money right now. All right, blah, blah, blah. It's nothing personal against you. It's just that I tell you straight up, if you would have called me and KRS would have called me at the same time with the same idea, I definitely would have gone with KRS, only because there's a certain part of me that is leery to get with anyone because of what I've been through. You forget, we did this out of innocence. There was no gimmick. We did it to come together in the community, our alternative form of recreation. We were creating it, and we didn't even know what we were creating.
Exactly.
And then we realized that when places like the Roxy's and the Grill and Dance Interior started opening, they were giving us guest lists of like 50 people here. Bam, got 100 people on his guest list. Legs, you got 50 people for your rock, steady, boom, boom, boom.
Right.
And meanwhile, all these white people that were coming in to see us, that were coming from the Bronx and Manhattan or whatever, were coming to see how we live. Instead of going to the jungle, they brought the jungle to the club, and we were the spectacle. So we're like, I realize that now, so I'm like, wait a second, I'm not going in the cage for no one else anymore.
I understand that, but I think the best way to, and I think that if KRS-One would have called me, and Tom Dick would have called me, and Tom Dick, I didn't know Tom Dick, and I don't know KRS-One, because I ain't never sat down and had a conversation with KRS-One. So what I would have done is sit down, have a conversation with KRS-One, had a conversation with Tom Dick, and then based on those two conversations, I would have made my decision. But I wouldn't okay. jump the gun to
That's
say,
you,
oh,
though.
Because KRS-One. Excuse me. I think, though, what needs to be done is that y'all need to find out what is going on, because there's a hell of a lot of grassroots people that's doing a hell of a lot for hip-hop. But because they are not well known or they don't have a celebrity attached to their name, they don't get the respect they deserve.
It's because, wait a minute, you don't have to be a celebrity, but where were all these grassroots people? See, people think hip hop started in the 80s. Where were all these grassroots people?
We weren't born.
Listen, no, okay, but there were other grassroots people there that totally ignored the ghetto. That's why we had to come up with our alternative form of recreation.
Y'all need to chill. We getting too much on the I syndrome. Let's think about the US syndrome and get some solutions of what's happening now.
If there be two museums, then y'all should be affiliated. I think it makes a difference how many museums. We should have hundreds scattered all over the world.
I want to go back to the original question that Chris asked about preserving the culture. And I think the best point, this is just my personal, is the point that my man made over here, because I don't really have long to be here, but the one thing I want to say to y'all is that ain't even about us, it's about them little shorties.
That's right.
The shorties is going to be the ones to preserve it, because we're going to be out of here.
Right.
I think that when people start thinking about hip-hop, I think we need to start providing. I can't do no better than my man. He a teacher, and I know that's like in the gut. Cause right. I walk to my kids is in public school, and I be wishing I was a teacher sometimes. Cause the teachers be like stressed, and I be like, yo, I could do that. You know what I'm saying? But I'm saying I think that the issue of the kids and stuff, you know, I think that's really important. I know a lot of people look at, you know, I don't know how everybody feels about hip hop right now. I know a lot of people love it. I know some people here probably don't know what it is. You know, I'm kind of mid-level. I wasn't with Legs and Bam and them, but I was in there like right after. You know what I mean? And I grew up on their tapes. That's about the closest I came. And I had my first, I'm old school Brooklyn with all of the guys, but I'm just saying I wasn't there with them. I think that, you know, a lot of people might have discrepancies with rap is going and all of that. But I think that people need to realize that none of this stuff moves without young people. And young people are viewing rap artists and what they know as hip-hop a certain way. Right. If we want to impact society in terms of the way they think about hip-hop, then I think that it's probably on the two levels that them two guys are talking about, between Chris and my man right here. Because Chris seemed like he want to bum rush the executives, and I'm with him. Let's just beat up about five of them, and our message will be straight. We won't even have no more fucking problems. All y'all gotta do is call me. I'll do the beating, little as I am. That's what I'm saying. And on the other level, it's about impacting the shorty. On the other level, it's about these kids, because these kids are seeing a certain thing and they admiring a certain thing that goes on around the country.
Right.
And they're the ones that end up making the difference. At the end of the day, it's them that make the difference. All of this shit that we going through and all that, it's because of kids. It might be white kids starting to feel our flow and their parents ain't feeling their flow, but it's all about kids. It ain't about adults at all.
Right.
Most of the people I'm looking at is adults in this room. And it ain't about us at all. It's about them little shorties. Them little shorties will tell you if you whack or if you ain't whack. Straight off. Why you don't like so-and-so? Because he old to me now. Why you like Snoop? Oh, because da-da-da-da. Why you don't like that? I'm telling you, these shorties will tell you all in all. I mean, we don't really have to go through. All we got to do is listen to Chris records to find out about why, you know, society, you know, is fucking ahead of the TV and all that. So all y'all gotta do is off. You know what I'm saying? But I'm just saying, the bottom line is that the only thing I wanted to say is that to answer the first question about preserving it, I think it's all about the little shorties. If we don't give them shorties something to look at that they can admire and that they want to touch out and that they want to be, then we ain't gonna win with them anyway. It's just gonna be somebody else to move in on their life and say I'm top dog, because that's all it is around the country.
TC Islam then proposed an apprenticeship program called the Zulu Media Education Project, where young people could get the technical skills needed to create their own jobs. He said as an example,
now say we have like a hip-hop DJ, like a DJ. He gets paid to show shorties how to DJ. See, what we need to do is start teaching these shorties how to do camera work. 9 times out of 10, what's the biggest problem at shows? Yo, sound man, what's up with my dad? go in the studio, I got a rock engineer trying to give me a hip-hop sound. Mm. But I got a shorty around my way who got a four-tracker, and all he's doing is looping beats. He got an ear for this. So, but yo, technically, he does not know how to go into the studio, and he look at 24-track board and go, oh my God. But if he gets the technical training, not only does he have an ear for it, but he got the heart and the soul for it. So I take my man Shorty on tour. He's working in the studio with me. I got a sister who has a concept for rap videos, but does not know anything about editing, steady cams, or anything like that. Now she's getting the technical training at the age of 14, 15. So what we have to do is give them the opportunity to create their own jobs within this culture of hip hop. And that's the only way it will be preserved. You understand where I'm coming from?
Yeah.
You know what I'm coming from?
Yeah.
Training the shorties, that will be taking them off the streets. We're giving them something that they love, because right now the carrots that are dangled in front of their faces are drugs, guns, these fake images of participating in the American dream, or should I say scheme, of things. You know what I'm saying? So we got to rescue our kids with what? This hip-hop, kid. You can get paid by doing this, man. Make your own job. You know what I'm saying? That's something you love doing.
Ugly, okay.
Yeah, it's, I mean, the conversation we're having here is excellent, because a lot of vibes, thoughts are happening now. One thing, let me just reiterate, the original question was, can you be professional and be a part of hip-hop? Brother here mentioned that define professional. We never really got around to that, but let me throw it on the floor. And say, number one, that in one breath, being professional is sort of like going through college. It's like, but just before you get to college, when you're taking an entrance exam, you know what you want to be, you know what you want to do, you're going to fight for this, you're going to fight for that. But then when you actually go through college, when you pick up your degree, you're somebody else. My point was, or is, can you be a part, can a Afrika Bambaataa, can a Kool Herc be A&R at a record company? Play that game and be true to the cause. I'm not saying it can or can't happen. I'm still trying to figure out.
You brothers taught us, who are right now in college, how to do that. You taught us that I can be criminal-minded and still make a contribution to my community with my double major in chemistry and biology. You told us that he can go back in the community and have his locks and be a professional and show these young kids, yo, you can do this and you can be that. So we can do that. And anybody who says you can, you're wrong.
Right. But I think
you can't define yourself to some parameters set up by somebody else. You got to define your own self the same way y'all did. The same way when I was growing up, you know what I'm saying? When I was the smartest kid in the class, everybody's like, yo, you corny, man, you whack. Nah, that's not the case. Yo, I'm going to use my mind to further myself and everybody else. And y'all showed me that I can do that. You know what I'm saying?
The way you can do that is, you gotta know that you can't let money become your god.
Right. Don't compromise.
You cannot compromise. You gotta be just like.
Wait, let me raise one other thing. I'll give you a chance. I gotta even wait. In terms of money being a god, right? We cannot. I mean, that will cloud everything. But the system in which we're under attack under is capitalism, in which we are going to need some kind of economic plan.
No, I'm not saying that. You know you're going to need economics, but what I'm saying, like, selling out. Like, if you feel, like, whatever I believe, I'm ready to die for. Now, if I say that, if I feel that the company's not going my way, then I'm ready to quit.
Right.
And let somebody else take that job. I'm not going to take the money you give me to sell out my people or to sell out hip-hop, you know, offer big money that you give it to me.
That's
familiar with this.
Well, that's my point. If everybody is real with this, then we're going to wind up not being professional, because we're not going to take the shit. We're not going to say, let's jerk this artist because he got dreads and this guy got Jerry curls. We're going to go with him. You know to your heart that shit is whack. But if you say, I'm pushing these dreads right here, that's what it is, and you get fired. If we all do that, then we're going to wind up being in our nucleus again.
Now, I think this is the way you do it. It goes back to what Harry was saying earlier. He was saying that, you know, you walk through parks or whatever, and you see statues dedicated to leaders.
When all actuality, the motherfucker you looking at ain't really lead shit. He was just the face man. Now you see the artist out on stage. He's the face man. What you need is somebody that's not involved in the politics of music that's saying, yo, you owe your allegiance to me. You fuck up, you got to answer to me.
Check it out.
Wait a minute. The person who is professional then cannot truthfully say that they are a part of hip hop.
I think
they have to be accountable.
They have to be accountable to hip hop.
But if we're all doing it, see, the problem is that we're not all doing it. See, if this side of the room is like, yo, fuck that, you gonna do this, and that side is like, nah, then there's a division that you can drive through. But if we're all saying, no, fuck that, we all doing it, you can't divide, you can't go through that. See?
I think we need to even go deeper than that. We have to deal with some sort of spirituality. If we're talking about building anything, we have to deal with spirituality. We have to understand what it means when we do something. Like this brother said about his job. Now, if we're going to build, you know, what we're really doing is building a society. And part of society is what's wrong right now is we have no spirituality. So we have to bring spirituality back in effect. And once you have spirituality and you become strong within yourself, then you can define what is going to happen in your life. Yes, you may have just lost the best job you ever had because you demanded to hear rap music on your radio, but your spirituality will keep you strong and keep you moving, and you know things will only get better from there.
After a short debate with everyone throwing in ideas and many voices speaking at the same time, Africa Bambaataa again called the meeting to order by saying,
the whole structure, discipline, order. It still comes, whether you have professionalism, whether you don't have it, it still comes all under one roof as getting it all together under a union to put out ideas, to have structure, to have people accountable, and let them know if they fuck up, you out the door, and the next one is in. You got to have a whole accountable, disciplined order, and to formulate a union, and we got to put our money where our mouth is, and be doers of the words. One thing that we could learn from, you know, watching the Nation of Islam is getting up and doing something for self. And that's what it all bows down to, that we got to get up and do something for self. Right now, hip-hop belongs to other people. And we got to take it back and put our mouth there. Get the ones that sitting on the higher top that got dough. Come on and sit down. Some of our basketball stars, our other professionalism, because that's the only thing we have is our artists. We don't control the agencies that book us, just like we don't control where we live at.
But the ironic thing is, without us, they don't have shit. That's the whole bottom line. Without us, they don't check us out.
They organize us.
The bigger irony is they do have us.
No. They have some of us.
They have most of us.
They got $780 million of us.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah, we got to keep it real. I mean, I know everybody's really dying for the cause and all that, but I'm going to be dead honest. Okay? Cool Herc, man, y'all are from a dying breed of brothers out here called, I don't give a fuck, I'm going for mine. That unity is dead.
Right.
Okay? Because of infiltration.
Right.
That's why when they say about the sellout is only a sellout if his mind is warped to that extent. Okay, right now, brothers in here is dealing about ESP, extra self-preservation. Mm-hmm. If it comes to your baby about to like starve and shit, but you down for the course, fuck that, your child gotta eat.
Right.
And that's how the mentality is. So we gotta realize, we gotta keep it real. I mean, I'm down to go for mine to the highest, but when you feel you in a dying course, you by yourself, you just gonna get shot bad. Well, he stood for his, nigga, out though.
You know what?
That's dead, man.
Check this out. A lot of brothers ain't selling out hip-hop, because you can't sell out what you was never down with.
When you didn't
okay.
create it.
Now, what they're doing is basically selling out their souls. That's what they're doing, because most of the brothers in the industry were never down with hip-hop culture. Okay, so they don't even understand how to use it for the community because they're worried about their pockets.
Tell us this one thing, because I think for the most part we've been dancing around an issue, for real. And the issue, when it comes down to it, is how do we acquire and maintain power? Because that's what it comes down to. Let me say a couple of things. In this professionalism piece, we don't want to confuse professionalism with white collarism,
right?
Because those are two different and separate things.
Right.
Professionalism means one that is proficient in a particular area. And it's the underline is accepted by their peers. You see what I'm saying? So a doctor just can't go out and claim that he's a doctor. He has to go through a mental learning process and then still be accepted by his peers.
Right.
And when we develop that kind of professionalism, it's going to weed out all the fakers anyway. The second thing, we do need to come to a definition of hip-hop that needs to be distributed. We need to come to a collective decision on what hip-hop is and define it in a way that gives some leeway. In other words, don't be so focused, don't be so narrow that you define everybody out of it, but define it within a context that people who are down with it can fit into it in some way, shape, or form. And the last thing is that we can't talk about power, because what I don't want to see, and I just tell you, what I don't want to see an archive that has all of the history of hip-hop, but in the street, it's not reflective of what went into that institution. Wow. And we don't want hip-hop or anything else to go the way of the dodo in the street, even though you have an archive that's sitting there. And the archive idea is the first step to that preservation. The last thing is that we can't even talk about power in hip-hop as if it is divorced from power and organization of young people. We can't talk about it because you can't play ball with one hand. I mean, you can try, and some people are good, but you will never be as effective as being able to use both hands. You'll never be as effective. So if we're talking about serious, a political move, a social move, an economic move, then hip-hop as an industry, as a form, needs to also be about the political and economic and social organization of our people. That's if it's it. Not about that, it's talking yin-yang.
That's it. Right. To the side. Right now, the bottom line is about money, all right? Money's going here. And it ain't concentrated in one place for us hip-hop build this. See, we need somewhere, a hip-hop complex itself, a large place that every artist who come to New York, who somebody, you have to come through there and perform. And that money goes somewhere for us, whatever we want to do with it. It's about money. It's about money and what hip-hop money could do for community and for us political-wise. It's a force. It just haven't been harnessed yet. Right? And we try to bring that shit under one fucking roof. That's all it is. We need somewhere that is hip-hop with a big fucking parking lot, a big fucking place to go everybody, so the police ain't got to come on horseback and chase it out of every fucking place that you can't get in. It got to be someplace like that in California. Where is that? East Coast, West Coast got to have a big fucking complex. And whoever made money off hip-hop got to be in that place. Otherwise, you can't go nowhere. That's how it's got to be. And anybody here?
This meeting continued on for several more hours. However, at the conclusion of this groundbreaking meeting, it was clear to all that hip-hop was more than just some good music and that it was time to organize culturally. It was here and at this time that I began gathering the notes, documents, and other inspirational materials to create a solid strategy toward what we said as a community, we wanted for ourselves as a group. This is where we began to seriously approach hip-hop as an international culture, and it was here that we set our cultural direction as a unique, self-conscious group of people. This is what we, as a temple for hip-hop, are loyal to. There have been numerous other follow-up hip-hop meetings, conferences, and summits since our 1994 meeting. However, the intentions of this first meeting are what the Temple of Hip-Hop remains most loyal to. These paragraphs are direct, unedited transcripts as to some of what was argued at our 1994 meeting of the Minds Conference. The underlined sections of this transcript are the direct influences and intentions of our hip-hop preservation movement. Study carefully, and not only use this piece of unedited history as an accurate reference for true hip-hop scholarship and activism, but through meditation and/or visualization, place yourself in the meeting as a citizen of hip-hop culture. What would you have said? What would you have suggested? After such a meeting, what would you have done? This particular transcript is very important to the awareness of the truly committed hip-hop activists. This is a major part of what guides the temple of hip-hop, and all true hip-hop is seeking to advance the culture of hip-hop. The time for talk and no action is over. The time for complaining with no plan of action has ceased. If we are truly serious about freedom, justice, and equality under just laws, it's time that we start acting like the community we keep begging America to be. America has its own problems, as do we. Therefore, let us get serious about our own future as hip-hoppers. Let us go down in history as the greatest urban movement of all time. Let us mature and rise to the cultural heritage that we have been born into. Let us as hip-hoppers fulfill the dream of our parents. This is the meaning of our movement. Yes, there are other movements of worthy cause, even worthy of more immediate attention. But hip-hop's preservation is what God has given to us as our task. Hip-hop is our burden. In history, this is what future generations will know our moves meant. Our moves for the preservation and further development of hip-hop include a full-service hip-hop city. And it is this ultimate vision that defines the meaning of our moves today. Our move meant. This is the meaning of why we move. But we also know that revolution only benefits those who participate in it. New ideas and revolutionary movements can be preached from every street corner in the world. But if the listener is still unable to participate in the actualization of such ideas and movements, then such talk is only entertainment. This is what hip-hop has been experiencing ever since our famous Meeting of the Minds conference in 1994. Even though many of us have spoken strongly and accurately about the challenges facing our hip-hop community, very few have actually organized themselves against such challenges. And even worse, when people like myself step up to begin the process of organization, fear, doubt, and distrust from our own people cripple our plans before we can even begin. I will call no names here because this gospel is a historical document that can have lasting effects upon the children of such saboteurs. Everyone should be given time to mature past their own fears. However, in my time, your past, I've been criticized as being a false prophet, cult leader, antichrist, and of wanting to own hip-hop, and even as being a member of the Illuminati. But all of these criticisms and critics have fallen to the wayside. I am only doing what we all said we wanted done. Those who are serious about hip-hop's preservation and further development have taken the vow, I am hip-hop, and have united with others to form the Temple of Hip-Hop, which is the actualization of our goals and collective vision. We have a plan, and we will fulfill it. In fact, in your time, my future, we have already fulfilled it. This is the meaning of our movement. Victory over the streets. There it is.
And there it is. Now, we're not done yet. We're just taking a break real quick so that you can digest what you just took in. This has been a long movement, and the movement is behind the scenes. As you can see, most of hip-hop has already participated, the early hip-hop has already participated in moves toward peace and prosperity and creating hip-hop as a legitimate global culture. We're already doing the work. But as we can see, there is a concerted effort to downplay or not play or avoid this kind of movement. It's a deliberate strategy that's being employed against us. And we gotta pay attention to this. I want to continue with this real quick and take you to the United Nations. On May 16th, 2001, we declared hip-hop an international culture of peace and prosperity at the United Nations headquarters in New York. Now, this is part of another Overstanding within the gospel of hip hop. But for our orientation, I'm gonna show this to you right now.
Welcome to the Temple of Hip Hop Ministries. The Temple of Hip Hop is a hip hop preservation society designed for the upliftment and promotion of hip hop culture. Hip hop is not just rap music. Hip hop is beyond rap music. Rap is something we do. Hip hop is something we live.
Hip hop came from the streets, it came from the house. It was an energy that the record companies gravitated towards.
Hip hop is our child, this is our baby. We gave birth to it.
See, hip hop taught me what love is. Rap taught me what a thug is. I'm just trying to spit it.
We're still menacing. The name of hip hop is still a ring. Shivers through people's bones.
Right now, there's a war between the state of hip hop.
I stand here before you, a representative of something we call hip hop culture. Words mean very little without definition. We are here to discuss the definition of hip hop. Once we deal with the definition, meaning, purpose, intention of hip hop, the words will change.
In rap, everybody's so focused on the hype and trying to live up to the hype.
You know, all the lyrics, the hoes, niggas, bitches.
They need to have some type of control of what they portray themselves as, because a lot of these kids don't have parents in the house to show them that. That's wrong.
Since 1994, we've been having meetings about the preservation of hip-hop as a culture. This is when Harry Allen, the media assassin, held a discussion at the Schomburg Center for an organization called the Rhythm Cultural Institute.
Yo, they got me
at that meeting, I decided to document the history of hip-hop and also begin to teach spiritual principles through the language of hip-hop.
To open up their eyes and see through these lies. Discipline themselves, yourself, to stay alive. Not many.
This then went on to the creation of the Temple of Hip Hop, which is at first a society that preserves hip hop.
This public safety issue is very simple.
One of the things that we haven't dealt with is how we've allowed ourselves to be degraded.
All day long on radio and television and print media.
Balls, niggas, bitches.
If all you see are people like myself and yourself.
Balls, niggas, bitches.
Depicted as criminals in these magazines with no other reference. It's now becoming a public safety issue.
Break it down. If you don't know me by now, why don't you ever know me? Never won a Grammy, won't win a Tony, but I'm not the only MC keeping it real.
Brothers get up there talking about killing people and they get on stage and thank God.
Our images shouldn't be played around with.
This is not a fan club. This is for people who are serious about hip hop's preservation. So the Temple of Hip Hop rose up and collected 29 paragraphs from various people in the industry to create the Hip Hop Declaration of Peace. This is a document that advises hip hop culture on ways in which it can sustain peace and join into the peace process. It was very important to go to City Hall and receive proclamations.
It's a great pleasure to be here and to celebrate Hip Hop Week and the hip hop culture. Understand, I'm a student of hip hop. I'm proud to say that.
In junior high with the B+ grade at the end of the day, I don't hit the hard grade.
Hip hop culture is positive, that's what it came. Don't waste your mind.
I've never seen any negative.
Believe in yourself.
Ever, from KRS-One.
A lot of times growing up with images and movies like Fort Apache and the Bronx, sometimes you got a low self-esteem and a low pride about the Bronx during the late 70s and 80s. And then came this young man with a song called the South Bronx. The South, South Bronx, the South Bronx.
The South, South Bronx, the South Bronx. The South, South Bronx.
These people can still pull me over because of the little music that I'm listening to. Because they can't understand that a young man with a sweatshirt and jeans and boots and a hat listening to hip-hop could actually be the assembly person. And so we have to change that. It's time for hip hoppers to stand up.
Put your head, listen to me, brother.
The leaders of today's hip hop movement will continue to advance their cause for generations to come. Hip hop has made a profound impact on our culture, our lives, and our world.
We then went to the United Nations and pretty much presented ourselves before an organization called UNESCO, the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization.
It is an honor that the hip-hop generation has joined us in this quest for peace in the world.
The Hip-Hop Declaration of Peace is an informal document that we have put together.
And in this document is the first step to something legitimate and something real.
Wherever the elements, culture, and expressions of hip-hop and the term hip-hop manifests, this hip-hop declaration of peace shall govern its use and interpretation. Hip-hop respects the dignity and sanctity of life without discrimination or prejudice. Hip-hop culture demands that hip-hoppers work to eliminate poverty, speak out against injustices, and to shape a more caring society and a more peaceful world. Hip-hop does not participate in any form of hate at any time. Those who are not hip-hop are prohibited from explaining or interpreting hip-hop to others. Hip-hop respects the laws and agreements of its culture, its country, and those it does business with. Hip-hop is the name of our collective consciousness. As a conscious way of life, we recognize our influence on society, especially on children, and we forever shall keep the welfare of both in mind. I want to thank you all for joining us here today on this Sunday. Thank you for being here and taking in this orientation. This is the establishment of hip-hop as a legitimate world culture. That's what the point is. And that's why we are approaching hip-hop philosophically, spiritually. This is why we are looking at ourselves beyond music. We have to leave something to our children and their children's children. If we don't get this right, being the first ones, the pioneers of this global phenomenon called hip-hop, if we don't get it right, imagine the generations to come after us that are going to have to start from scratch or without any generational wealth whatsoever. We have a chance to create something that is so secure for our children that no other force on earth can come in, destroy it, sabotage it, or so on. We have this strength, and that strength begins with unity. That unity begins with unity of thought. Once we are all thinking on the same page, nothing can stop us. We go straight to the top. So again, every Sunday, we do this from 7 to about 11 o'clock. We do this. Next week, we'll be getting into hardcore lessons. You've done the orientation. You know what this is about. If there's something that offends you or you don't believe in what we're doing or so on, we thank you for your time today. And there it is. Next week, though, we'll be getting deeper into our hip hop lessons. What you need to know about hip hop in order to see the spirituality that we're going to be discussing. Now, I'm not going to dwell on this here. This is just a brief overview of what you've seen so far. But let me make this clear. This is a street ministry. You should not compare this ministry to anything else. This is a new experience in spirituality and philosophical thought, even metaphysical thought. So, I'll see you next week. Thanks.
Woo!
Here's what we doing.
Check one, two. I like the way that sound. Wait a minute, I like the way that sound. Hold up now, old school.
Yes, yes, y'all. Rock, rock, y'all. KRS, y'all. Kick Capri, y'all. Let's go, y'all. Block party, y'all. Woo!
forget the hype, here's the lesson. Hip-hop culture turned 47. Kick Capri on the turntable weapon. KRS-One take it back, 77. Yo, just before the rap, long before TV and all of that. Two turntables, a mic and raw rap. Or rather MCing is what we call that. A jam, most of y'all never saw that. That's why right now we bringing it all back. KRS-One, I'm just a tall cat. Original MC, I can call that. Rappers today, what they say be all whack. DJ Kid Capri brings the boom back. Taking you back with skills, we prove that. I'm the MC, the crowd, I move that. Security's like, you got to move back. KRS rocks the old and new tracks. Whether rock, reggae, EDM, or trap, I rock the microphone, that's a fact. KRS Kid Capri back to back. We came first, you dudes came after that. That's why they all jealous. We the true legends, it's nothing they can tell us. No, you can't buy us, nope, you can't sell us. Whether over music or acapellas, we them good fellas, nope, we never fell. Organic intelligence is faster than Dell.